Good evening, everyone. I would like to welcome you all for our webinar for this evening. It is brought to you by the PG Examination Forum and Avesta, a branch of Sun Pharmaceuticals. PG Examination Forum is an initiative of Dr. Deepak Mishra. We have WhatsApp groups with 1500 members and 700 members on our Facebook group. We have conducted over 13 webinars till now. This is our 14th webinar. Today we will be talking about what after residency. We have the stalwarts talking on this topic. We have our chairpersons for today. There's Dr. Rajvardhan Azhar. He's the professor emeritus at Rio GYMS. And he is the chairman at USC Bihar. We have Dr. A.K. Grover, the chairman at Vision Eye Center, New Delhi. I would like to welcome our moderators. We have Dr. Deepak Bhatt, the faculty at Rio Institute He is also founder and admin of PG Examination Forum. He is also the chairman of Scientific Committee UPSOS. I would like to also welcome Dr. Satanshu Mathur. He is the chairman of Scientific Committee ACOIN, national convener at SSTC, secretary at NZSOS UKSOS. Our speakers for today are Dr. Rohit Shetty. He is the vice chairman at Narayan Netralaya, Bangalore. Dr. Krishna Prasad, he is the head of Pediatric Ophthalmology and Glaucoma Surgery Services at MM Joshi Eye Institute, Hubli. We also have Dr. Santosh Honawar. He is the director at Medical Services Center for Sight, Hyderabad, editor at IGO AIOS. Dr. Rashmin Gandhi, he is the consultant neuro-ophthalmologist at Center for Sight, director at Foresight Worldwide. And lastly, we have Dr. Vivek Dave. He's the consultant ophthalmologist at L.V. Prasad Eye Institute, Hyderabad. Welcome, sir. I would like to welcome Dr. Deepak, sir, to continue the rest of the webinar.
Thank you, Aishwarya. Now our chairperson, kindly stop sharing. Our chairperson, Professor A.K. Grover sir, is here. I would like to request him to say a few words before we start the webinar.
Thank you, Dr. Aishwarya and Dr. Deepak. I'm really happy that this wonderful platform of PG Examination Forum has been created by the initiative of the SSTC of the All India Ophthalmological Society. A forum like this was much needed. There is a lot that needs to be done for the residency education and fellowship education in this country. And we have a long way to go to achieve standards that are uniform and provide training which is to complete satisfaction of the teachers and the learners. So I think there is a huge path to travel. We've done a lot in the last decade or so where the standards have improved, but there is a lot more to be done. Today's webinar is particularly welcome because it talks about the options that all of our learners, our residents can have after they complete their residency training. And you have the topmost people in the field of ophthalmic education, people who can guide you the best with regard to your career options, with regard to your fellowship options, temporary options which are for the short term, and the long term options which can help you decide what is best for you. So we're looking forward to this webinar, and I'm sure our two moderators, Dr. Deepak and Dr. Satanshu, will do a great job and a wonderful faculty to follow. Hand over to our moderators. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Grover, sir. Thanks for the nice words. Now we have our eminent faculty with us, and among all, Dr. Rohit Shetty. We all know him. He always speaks from his heart. And today also he is going to guide our young postgraduates and fellows what to do in the life and what they can do in their research. Research is a topic which is Rohit is in heart. So Dr. Rohit, you are welcome here.
Yes, sir. Thank you. I would like to thank Deepak, Dr. Satanshu sir, Dr. Ashok Grover sir, an entire team of young postgraduates and residents who are who made this happen. My topic today was research, what to do after the residency. Many years back, maybe Dr. Grover sir or Dr. Rashmin Gandhi would remember, when we all finished our post-graduation, if you want to do research, the question always asked is that I should join a medical college, that it will help me in publishing few papers. If I publish few papers, maybe my promotion will be guaranteed. And if you have a real, real interest in pursuing research, then you have to probably come out of the country and go out somewhere else, you know, and join some institutes. So times have changed. When I finished my post-graduation, there was no real interest on doing research. And research, I mean, first question which comes to your mind to somebody youngster in this group is, why should I do research? I think the best answer to answer this is COVID. You know, it tells you that whatever you planned as before this March, you know, there's in one split of a moment, you know, everything changed. Now we all are now gone back to a stage where you know, none of us are we're struggling to get our patients back. We're struggling to get operated. So what I feel is one story which I remember very well for me to take up research 18, 19 years back was I met my uncle Dr. Devi Shetty then, and he said I was just joining this family, and he told me that your future is not an extension of your past. And I keep telling this multiple times as a mantra to a lot of my fellows, that you assume that if your future is doing more surgeries, more and more skill, there are extremely lot of people doing the same skill. The first thing is that if people have the same skill, then how do you be differentiator? If you can't be a differentiator, it becomes very difficult in life to progress further, because everybody has the same skill. I look at this like a penguin on a shore. And there were beautiful photographs Dr. Grover sir had shown from penguins in Antarctica when he went. I mean, it's a fantastic place to see them. And if you ask him, you can't differentiate one penguin from the other. Each penguin may be thinking that I may be a superior one, but there's no differentiation. So if somebody comes to me for a job today, and today it's impossible to differentiate one from the other because your surgical skill training is more or less the same. What really makes a difference is what else do you have? So today research is not about trying to make something which is very fancy. Research is all about trying to safeguard your future. So I would consider research now as one different step which will not make you a similar looking penguin. It will try to make you somebody different. For example, when you do research, it does not mean that it's all about just picking up some random stuff and doing it. So second thing, when you talk about research, is there are maybe 10, 15 good institutes in the country which does very good work of research. You pick up one of them and you go meet them, and you have to do a lot of efforts. You can't just send your CV of your post-graduation and then expect somebody to pick up research. You have to do a lot of work. You have to make them believe that you are the person for this job. Because like you, we are also looking for people who don't want to be penguins. So that is the second important step. You have to make a move. Your first time, people may not respond to you. But you have to do a lot of homework in finding out which place I want to apply, and you have to freeze it. It's like a cruise missile. Once you freeze it, you should not leave this ever. Even if you take 1 year, 2 years, you have to go for it. People may reject you initially, but you eventually, if you are very, very serious, then we know that you are the person for this. So how is it going to change? One thing it's going to change is going to make you completely a different person. You are not going to be the same as you were. Research may not make you more skilled, but it will start making you more intelligent, more thoughtful, more conscious, more mindful. I can use a lot of these words. Research makes you keep balance in life. For example, in times like COVID, you know, when a lot of people were stressed about patients, we made sure that we were able to publish more than 22 papers from March 21st to end of May. 22 papers is virtually maybe 2 or 3 papers. And we have submitted more than 60 papers. So we looked at COVID as an opportunity to come out of unwanted negativity around. So research was for us in this moment of time a completely divine feeling which pulled us out of all negativity and concentrate on what we can do. Out of 22 papers, 10 were on COVID only. So if you want to do a long-term research, there's a short-term, okay, I want to do research during my fellowship, that is okay, that's one type of research. There's long-term research, like places like us, and I'm sure Elvi Prasad, they also offer a PhD program and 3 years program. You can't, see, once you get PhDs, or once you get these kind of opportunity, this is for life. Nobody can take this thing away from you. A lot of you are very young, but what I see is there's a tremendous amount of hurry to finish and come out. See, if you finish and come out, you'll end up only being a penguin. If you want to be a different animal, people recognize you, or if you want to be a differentiator, you have to give your time. If you want to do a quick fix, learn the same FACO, same thing, same refractive surgery, I can train a refractive surgeon in 3 weeks. But there is a difference. Surgically, there's no difference between a 3 weeks refractive surgeon and a 3 year surgeon. But in a thinking wise, one is a kindergarten, the other one is at something else. So you have to understand, you want to be a kindergarten stuff or you want to be something else. To sum up here, for me, you take up research if it's calling, but don't take up research because it's something new and different, because that doesn't work. Because research of any kind needs tremendous amount of grit and passion. If you don't have it in you, then don't take it, because you will kill a lot of your own self-esteem and everything. But if you have that even 1% interest or liking in you, then go for it all out. And there will always be, see, if you, it's the chemical vibration. If you show it, the person you go for interview will pick it up. If you don't show it and you just come and say that you are just casual about it, nobody's going to pick it up. And look at it as a short term or a long term. Short terms are few papers, writing papers, statistics, research methodologies, all these things come in short term. Short term is 2 years. Or you said, I want to be a PhD in one area, and this is my dream. I want to do a lab science. And finally, when I say research, nobody is going to go out, at least in a country, not doing surgery. I have every single fellow of mine or people I have trained, I make sure that they have to face the hardship of life, which is getting patients, going back to the OT, because that is what feeds you. Ultimately, that is what is going to be your bread and butter. But there is something you sing for your soul. That is what the research is. You ask me, if you balance it both, I think it's in today's context, you don't need to go anywhere out abroad. There are so many institutes in this country which can give you both. And in India, in that way, we are very well merged, that we know that life depends on surgical skills, basic skills. All that is going to be groomed well, unlike in the West, where you can only be a lab researcher. So if you can balance it well, I think the world is yours. I thank you, Deepak sir and the Grover sir and all the young students out here who have made this beautiful forum, and Dr. Mathur sir. Thank you.
So all the fellows and all the PGs, you should listen to his talk very carefully. He has given you tips when you are going for the fellowship, because Narayan Netal is the biggest provider of the fellowship nowadays. So he has given you tips. You should have some extra efforts there other than the MS or MD degree or DNA degree. You should be inclined towards the research work. So he has given a great hint. You should be careful when you are going for an interview or for fellowship. You are applying for this.
So, what about Dr. Grover, sir? Did you find a difference between the penguins in Antarctica?
Yes, I think over it.
Five varieties, but there would be thousands of each variety. So you can subgroup your PGs also. But that's it. Then you, when you need a distinguisher, you need a quality. You need a heart's calling that you want to do something different. And that is what comes out in the researcher. If it is your calling, if you are fond of asking questions and you want answers to them in a scientific manner, and your heart is in it, then you certainly can be a researcher. And we need a lot of questions that are specific to India to be answered. And unless we answer them, nobody else will do it for us. And that's why the effort by Rohit, his team, and other researchers in the country are doing a yeoman job, because nobody else is going to answer the problems that we face. And that is why research is important. So collaborative research, multi-centric research should take off in a big way. And I think our centers are taking the lead in that.
Rohit, problem in India is, not in India, but everywhere, is that once you get the degree, you get the fellowship, you have crossed the age around 30 years. So everybody wants to go in the private practice or professional or join a job earning money. So there should be something like this, that you are doing research also, you are earning a great money also. So people are more inclined towards the research. You have to find out some ways. Because our time, we were not every at all, we were knowing about any research. But now you people, like Rohit has definitely opened a new platform in India especially.
As Dr. Rohit will testify, you can live a very luxurious life by doing just research in the US. But yes, that's not true in India. So you have to possibly at this stage be a clinician as well, as Dr. Rohit pointed out, for you to be eating your bread and doing your research.
Absolutely. Because it's very difficult to have only one thing in India. So all our programs are tuned in such a way that they do both. At the end of it, they should. It's more difficult because if you don't have a fixed, and in the West, you know, whole day you can spend on one paper reading. Here, the whole day you spend doing your OPD, OT and everything. At the end of the day, when you're really tired, then you get back to the real work. So I think it's not easy. I mean, if it was easy, then everybody would do it.
So Rohit, about the funds, from where the funds will come?
See, it's like they say, you know, I always believe that there's a very nice proverb which says that when you jump, the net will appear. So if you're always worried about the net, whether, you know, what's going to happen when I jump, then you'll never know what is there. So once you start working on it, invariably you will start finding. We also started with no funds. We don't have any donations. We don't have any philanthropic thing. But what happens is we start writing grants. There's so many grants. It will take time. It will test your patience. The government grants are there, ICMR. I mean, of course, now there's a lot more devoted to thing. But most important thing for a researcher is you have to align yourself with what the government wants. For example, if you want to get money for a research at this point of time, you have to align your research to COVID. If you write a research grant of, say, 1 crore rupees to syphilis or leprosy, you'll never get it. So you'll always get rejected. So what is important is you have to align your research to what the country wants. And that is not difficult, because if you go to any of their websites, they will write what they're looking for, what the grant is for. Sometimes the grant is for combining Ayurveda with an allopathy medicine. So you can combine one of your drugs. You can combine, say, turmeric, curcumin in some rheumatoid or one of the thyroid eye diseases. So these things are very specific. We have to do a lot of homework. And that is an effort, but if you need money, we have to do it.
So as Dr. Rohit said, there are a number of organizations that are financing. If you write a good enough project, it is almost certain that somebody will pick it up, ICMR or CSIR or DST or any of those departments will be able to fund it if it is a good enough project. So you have to get good at thinking out a question and writing a good viable project. Secondly, jaise kehte hain ki if you desire something strongly enough, the khudai will get together to
conspire.
Conspire to put things together for you. So okay. You have to
Dr. Deepak, Dr. Rohit,
yes,
KP here. I have seen the things in US as well as in India, but do you think that in Indian ophthalmologists are so busy, as you said, from morning till evening, is that a deterrent for research, or actually is it should actually be supportive? Do you think that somebody who is tired from morning till night, seeing patients operating, does it sometimes work against the research?
Sir, if you really look at research in the West, it is all, I never worked as a researcher in the West. Even now I'm a PhD guide to two European universities. What I feel a difference is we are way, way, way ahead if you really put our mind and efforts into it. I'll tell you why. One, they work on very, very small areas, which is only funded. They don't do anything which is not funded. They don't do anything which is, that means basically they don't think anything which they're not paid to think. So for example, if they have a grant on, say, infantile esotropia, they will only do infantile esotropia, even if they have a very good project which they can do research on a alphabet pattern. They think that it is not for me. But in India, what we do is, like you and me and a lot of us here, we don't look at research as an end of the day job. We look at research as we keep seeing patient. You may be seeing patient. I keep seeing a lot of your tutorials on refraction. I keep forwarding it to a lot of my students. With the passion you treat, I don't see you look at it as a job. I'm sure I see the lights on. I'm sure it must be your evening after OPD, you must be taking the thing, or it must be morning because the lights are on. That means that if you take this as a job, I will not see that love and passion of training when you teach about what is a compound myopic and those simple stuff. So what I see in lot of us in here is that we are able to turn around our research projects and at least 3 or 4 years ahead of what it would happen if it was done in a Western world. And for them, they would answer only one question, and that is a question which has been funded, or that is a question they have been asked to fund. It's more like a robot working. Here, what happens is we ask 10 questions, of which 5 we try to answer. And many of us don't even feel that at the end of the day, we feel tired and we are taking a new job, because that is exactly like how you teach at the end of your OPD, exactly the same passion as you would teach if it was a day off for you. And I have all my lab scientists are all, we have something like 60 of them who are all, most of them are PhDs and who are my pure lab scientists. And out of which around 50% of them have worked in the universities abroad, including NIH and other things. And they all relocated to India because of this one thing, that we are able to ask many questions. We are able to bring out faster. And we are able to bring out much, much more quicker than what we would see in any other country. I feel that we are much, because now I can understand this because I'm a PhD guide. And what I have three of them, I guided three from India. Ashwin Mohan will be this year. And they have probably done the PhD in half the time it would take in the same university in Europe. And with better papers than what I see in them. Because they don't work on Saturday, Sunday, Friday afternoon. They stop everything. And they're all paid, so there's no fire in the belly that they have to finish within 2 years or 3 years. I mean, this is my answer, sir.
Rohit, thank you very much for encouraging words, telling us that India is far ahead of European country in research. We are never thinking of it. And I have been to your lab of dry eye once upon a time when I visited your hospital. Definitely at 3 or 4 years back, you were doing the work which we could not imagine at that time. So thank you, Rohit. Thank you. Aishwarya, now invite the next speaker.
Ritu will invite, sir. Ritu is no moderating.
Please invite the next speaker. Unmute yourself.
Am I audible now,
sir? Yes, yes, you are audible. Yes.
Okay. Good evening.
Your internet is slow, Ritu.
Your audio is poor. So, Ritu, your audio is poor, so I need to Deepak, I will shoot it.
Hello.
Ritu, your audio is poor, so please check your net. So, we invite next speaker, Dr. Keshav Prasad. We all know he's a great teacher, and he will tell you about most important thing, what to do after the PG exams and DNB exams. Because you people are appearing the exams. Now, next question will be, how to get, after getting through the exam, what is your path next? Dr. KP. Ritu, please check your net.
Sir, yes, yes. I've checked it, sir.
KP.
So, good evening. Thank you very much, Dr. Deepak, Dr. Satanshu, my good friends, and Dr. Grover, and all the people, the elite faculty that we have, and all the postgraduates who have gathered here, both online and offline. This is a program which is very close to my heart because the PG Examination Forum, and has, you know, kind of got into SSTC combo, is really doing a great job. I've seen their earlier webinars. I think this is one very important topic they have touched upon. I think I'm very glad that I'm a part of it, and really heartwarming to see such a good response from the postgraduates, which was always a felt need of the postgraduates. See, I'm a postgraduate teacher. I always get to know from postgraduates that they always find the PG course very trying, very demanding, very difficult, very uncertain. So when they're going through their exam, process preparing for the exam, because we do conduct certain training program for the actual PG examinations. Most of them are really, freaked out about exams, passing, learning surgery. So all the things that make up a PG course and the run up for the exam, it's really very, very demanding. That is what they say. But I would rather say the other way around. I think when they pass the exam, when they come out with a degree, I think the real problems start. This is something I want to know, to every postgraduate should know. The life after post-graduation is more demanding, is more uncertain, is more trying, and that is where all the problem. Because post-graduation is basically a very time-bound task. You are doing certain specific things which have been told, supervised, and you are under the very cozy and very secure, because you are doing the things which everybody else is doing up to a particular time. But once you finish and you are out in the open, in the competition, you need to really prove yourself eligible, qualified for the practice ahead. But let me ask you one thing. What is that one important thing? What should be the aim? What should be the target? What should be the kind of, the goal that you all set, in which you put almost all your efforts, all your years, all your stay, and all the difficulties that you encounter? What is that one thing that you want to achieve after a postgraduate training? According to me, it is employability. Let us face it. Whatever you may say, the kind of competence, whatever you may like ophthalmology, but finally, at the end of the day, you have to be ready for the great ophthalmic industry. See, if I am in the interview committee, or if I am in the selection committee trying to hire consultants for my hospital chain, I would like to look for a person who's going to gel into the culture, who's hardworking, has the clinical acumen, is very well skilled, can generate the revenue for me, can do things, and can really, communicate well, and can get patients on his own competence. So that is all boils down to what we call as employability. So every PG who is right now in their training should ask themselves, are they employable at this point of time? Soon after their post-graduation, when they get the results, they have to ask themselves this introspective question, are they employable at that point of time? I think the answer to the majority, I think we have some postgraduates here. Any one of you, can you unmute yourself and answer this question? At the end of your PG course, are you employable? We have them? Anybody? I think we have some postgraduates. I think we have Ritu only. We have Aishwarya, Shiva, okay, and many more. Okay. One of you can tell, Raghu. What do you think? Are you employable? I mean, you may say yes. The answer need not be according to what I am talking. So, most people would have some doubts about this. So, that is where. So, we are asking this question, is our PG training good enough to make you employable? See, we have to understand the realities of life. The present day PG curriculum is so, you know, difficult to kind of comprehend. It is not enough because of the changing needs of the society, the ophthalmic community, and the changing technology. So we really do not know where, how we have to train a postgraduate. Okay, are they industry ready soon after their PG? So we think that probably not. So as Dr. Grover was alluding, we need some immense changes in the entire PG training curriculum, the way we approach this problem, and we have to make people more employable. So once you think that your PG training is not enough, once you finish your MS or DNB or DOMS, okay, what next? So basically the three, I would rather call it the three mistakes of your life. When you do your post-graduation, when you are during your post-graduation, what are the three mistakes you do? One is you never don a consultant mindset. Every postgraduate thinks like a postgraduate. We have been conditioned from undergraduate days to follow orders. We have been told to do certain things. We never come out of that closet and we never think like a consultant. This is something that some people have it as an innate ability. Some people don't get it even if they get into their profession. So you have to think like a consultant. When a patient comes, the way you approach, the way you communicate, the way you, you know, deal with this history, examination, come to DDs, think about investigation, look at the, not just the eye, the whole body, the patient as a whole, the holistic approach to the patient, okay, is something what a consultant learns over a period of time. I think a postgraduate has to think like a consultant from day one. So during your PG itself, you have enough skills, okay, to do better in your the next day, in your future years. And next is to letting go the opportunities to get inspired. This is one opportunity. I would rather say this particular webinar itself is an opportunity to get inspired. So wherever possible, you have physical meetings. Now, even though now they are rare, you have virtual meetings. You have opportunities to meet the great personalities, the achievers in life, the people who can inspire you. Go to them, talk to them, spend some time, see what they do, how they think. Okay, they are the opportunity where you get an inspiration. They probably tell you which way, what is your future and how you have to do it. And many of them are ready to share their secrets, ready to give you tips, ready to help the youngsters. So please see that you always have a mentor. A teacher is different. A mentor is different. The mentor need not teach you ophthalmology. The mentor tells you how to go about your ophthalmology and how to get inspired. And nextly, the ignorance about market. This is what I'm saying. A PG hardly knows what subspecialty is in hot demand, which subspecialty has got a more incubation period, where is the venture capitalist money going in, where are the, you know, how the chain of hospitals are coming up, where are our employment opportunities, which sectors actually are doing well. So which are the places, I mean, many of them will go and join a metro and try to get into, make a fortune there. There are a lot of opportunities elsewhere. So trying to understand the market, basically the future market, is the another mistake that they do. So basically, can you fit into a job? Let us say earlier it used to be the thing like that. Our PG was good enough. Little ophthalmology was known. So after you do it, everybody would be almost doing the same thing. There was no need for excellent escalation of skills or some kind of, you know, extra training that was required. So now this question is very difficult to answer. Only in certain situations, places where they don't, the job doesn't expect you to do more, probably there's a very low expectation, low-key jobs you can get in. Soon after a PG degree, unless you are a really very brilliant, you have worked really hard, you have been really gone through a lot of training, and you have already donned the consulting mindset, as I already told you, normally just doing a job soon after PG would be little impractical and may not really be a very good option for most of them if they are looking for a very bright future. So what happens if you take a job soon after that? Normally you end up as a lower rank personnel. There's a lot of hospitals where they do take fresh graduates, basically clear the OPD, screen the cataracts, prescribe certain, you know, progressives, and probably work as an OPD clearance personnel. You can't scale up in the subspecialty level. You are not given surgical chances because obviously it's a money-spinning enterprise. So if you are in a big setup, you are at the lower end. If you really go to a remote place where you are the only one, charitable setup, stressed hospitals, normally you will be doing a very low-key work. There you lose your precious years in slogging unproductively. Unproductive in the sense you may pick up some surgeries and surgical skills and clinical skills, but only thing is that may not be really recognized outside if you really want to come into the arena where more of corporate setups or chain hospitals probably may not really take that rural service or a small area setups as something very productive. And obviously that will help in, you know, that will make you to lower expectations. You will have a low key setting, I mean low goal setting. Obviously your whole, you will be normally in a conference, you will be on the other side of the table. Okay. So you can actually go onto the podium and address the people, or maybe you will be in the majority of the audience on the other side of the podium. So what I normally tell you, this should be, as Dr. Rohit was alluding, the fire in the belly is something, okay, that you all should have. I always say that what is worse than losing is to keep a low target and win it. So you dream small, you aim very low and you achieve it. That is actually worse. It is better to aim very high and actually lose it. Okay. So, but what does a fellowship or a senior residency, like you in the same place where you did your PG or maybe anywhere else, I would rather advise that you should not do your senior residency or fellowship in the same place. It's better to go to another place because you try to get the, you know, good things of both the places. It always makes you better and more adaptable. So when you are doing a fellowship, see what it does to you. So is fellowship really essential? You are putting up, investing another 2 years, maybe delaying your family milestones, personal milestones, marriage, having kids, and I mean having our own money earning, everything gets delayed. So that is what is a transformation from a novice to an expert. See, you are a novice as a postgraduate. You are very raw. Any patient who is sitting in front of you will understand in 1 minute that you are very novice. You are probably not capable of handling this. Just looking at your way you handle him, you will understand. An expert, the confidence, you know, actually sees through. Patient can see through the confidence, the conviction of the person. So it is not just the ophthalmology knowledge. In fact, a PG who has just finished post-graduation exam will probably know more ophthalmology in terms of quantum of ophthalmology than a very seasoned expert or a successful practitioner. But the expert knows what is the practical knowledge. Okay, you may know evidence-based medicine, but he knows eminence-based medicine. So he can understand, measure up each patient, try to give what is best for that particular situation. He doesn't just look at the eye, he looks at the whole patient. Okay, the way he convinces, the way he gives a prognostication, the way he, you know, tackles things, okay, which is, you know, something which every novice has to become an expert. So giving a fellowship training or a residency opportunity, senior residency opportunity, will give you add some more training years. This is where, as a PG, you are just logging to pass. You are not really thinking of your patient in your practice. But in fellowship, you don't have that fear of exams. Now your entire focus is on how to actually examine a patient, how to make a diagnosis, how to treat, how to follow it up. So you become more focused on what is relevant for tomorrow's practice. I think it gives you an analytical thinking. What is very important, you may see a patient. Like, why our postgraduates find it so hard to present a case in the exam? Because they never understand case presentation like a storytelling. You just have to pick up points in history, examination, put everything, make a DD and try to do investigation and try to give what could be the most likely problem the patient has and what is the most appropriate investigation and treatment he is likely to receive. So this analytical thinking, you may get it if you are fortunate enough during your post-graduation itself, but probably it would require some more years. Clinical acumen, the more patients you see, the more slogging you do, really you have to work hard during your fellowship. And obviously the surgical training. Surgical training cannot be overemphasized. It is very important. The number of surgeries that you do makes you more confident. You get to see all kinds of cases during a fellowship. In a post-graduation, that may not be the case in all cases. So surgical training is something that is really important, which probably is the fruit of fellowship. And you have to complete the ordeal. See, what happens in a post-graduation, you see a patient and go away, or you are basically a testimony, a part of the treatment. In a fellowship, you are working in a particular department. You see a patient from, he walks in, what happens, investigation, treatment, follow-up, he comes back again, second surgery. So you know completely what happens. For example, if you are treating a child of an infantile esotropia or an accommodative esotropia, from the day the child comes in, to what is happened, cycloplegic refraction, glasses, follow-up, surgery, follow-ups. So basically you know the entire story and you end up completing the ordeal, and that gives an imprint of what normally cases that you expect in your practice. And very importantly, most postgraduates, there's no curriculum for communication and soft skills. In no undergraduate or postgraduate training, there's a class or a curriculum for you to how to speak to a patient, how to counsel a patient, how to give a bad prognosis, how to break the bad news, how to give, what are all the things that factor in while you're talking to your patient. So all these soft skills and communication skills, because today's children are more into their screens, their screen time is more than the people time. So we are all from the old generation. We have always been gossiping from training small in childhood. So we know how to talk to people. Today's postgraduates or today's undergraduates hardly talk to people. They talk to their smartphones and not to people. So this is something that... So what is our problem with your PG training? Basically, I'll tell you one thing. In your PG, what happens? We are giving you a question in the exam. Give me etiopathogenesis, differential diagnosis and treatment of ocular sarcoidosis. So this is that you prepare for ocular sarcoidosis under this heading. But in practice, what happens? Patient comes back with a symptom. Patient comes back with a presentation. There is nothing written on his forehead that is ocular sarcoidosis. Okay, the question has to be like this. So what are the differential diagnoses, or how do you manage a patient who has been having gradual loss of vision over 6 months, or somebody who had lost vision just 5 minutes ago? What is the bilateral loss of vision just for 5 minutes? So these are the things the patient comes with. And we have never trained our postgraduates to move from symptoms to the diagnosis. We know from diagnosis to symptom. We have already told you it's ocular sarcoidosis. So you go up and read what is symptoms, what are signs. You have to do the reverse engineering. So when we train our PGs from symptoms and say this symptom, this could be there. So that is why there's so much problem in giving differential diagnosis to each symptom. So that is what is our training problem. So finally, we have to have a plan B. See, there is no hurry to get trained. Okay, not that just immediately after your PG, you will get a best opportunity to get trained. Always, if you do not get a fellowship, if you do not get a senior residency, there has to be a plan B. You can always come back and get ophthalmologies for a lifetime. There is no time-bound thing that in 2 years you have to finish your training and start earning money. You keep on learning. You understand as a consultant, you keep on earning money. You keep on learning ophthalmology and you keep on becoming better. Okay, so you can always keep learning, and anytime you can come back to ophthalmology with a bang and always have a plan B. And always, I see a lot of postgraduate, girl postgraduates here. I think 80% of today's input into ophthalmology is girls. So there are definitely gender specific issues. Okay, see, girls have to marry, they have to have kids, then they have to, family comes in, they have more responsibility. And I always feel that women are superwomen. They can multitask, they have to sometimes have a difficult choice between family and personal milestones and career moves. I think this is very important. Many of the girls are confused about this. They say, if I don't do a fellowship, what will happen? Okay, how can I marry now? So So they delay the personal milestones. See, I'll tell you one thing. Ophthalmology, you can practice till 75. But these things have to have as per the time. Okay, I think it applies to even men for certain things. What I'm trying to say is family comes first. Your personal milestones are more important. You can always come back to ophthalmology. I have seen multiple examples where people have taken a backseat for a very important reason, okay, for prioritizing the things, and they have always come back with a bang to ophthalmology. So make sure that you have proper choices. Don't delay the vital things. The family milestones are more important. Ophthalmology will stay, okay, and you can always, you know, get back to the same thing, and you become rather more mature in your thinking. You will be more appropriate for your clinical training. So please understand, okay, the women, the girls, I think you need to really, you are the taskmaster, and you need to really make a decision very appropriately. And always, I'll tell you, merit always wins. We have been hearing a lot about nepotism, groupism, things, a lot of in the, because of so many recent things. But finally, let me tell you, if you're meritorious, nobody can snub you. You will always find your place. Finally, the patient is the biggest examiner. Always tell, don't worry about examiners in the exam. No problem. They may fail you, pass you. But the patient who sits in front of the biggest examiner, who will decide your fate? If you're good, nobody can snub you in. Okay? And never just go behind the success. You first become competent. Okay, this is very important. Aap kamyaab hono bas. I don't kamyaabi zak par ke piche aayegi. Don't worry. Once you become good, so your idea is to become employable. So after your PG, learn ophthalmology with your heart and soul, become good, pick your clinical acumen, do surgeries, hands-on, become, you know, competent. There will be a, you know, big demand for you. So present day, there is a boom in ophthalmology. A lot of venture capitalist money is coming in. Chain of hospitals are sprouting. So we need very good, talented ophthalmologists. We need productive ophthalmologists who can really do their job. India has a huge population, 1.3 billion into two, so many eyes, 2.6 billion eyes with all problems. So see that you ride the wave and be there. And future is very bright, let me tell you. So please make sure that you are there at the right time, at the right place to ride the wave. All the best. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for a wonderful talk, sir. It was really informative. And it couldn't be more didactic as you could. Moving ahead, we have our next speaker, the exceptional Dr. Santosh Honawar, sir. And he is going to light up a little on going local to global. And his topic is training abroad. Over to you, sir.
We all know Santosh. There is no need to introduction to him. And he's the best person to tell you, after India, how can you approach the outside internationally?
Thank you so much. Thank you, Deepak and Satanshu, for the opportunity. Well, KP has spoken at length about what you should do after your residency. And a step ahead is, if you really want to kind of polish yourself before you start your practice, then international fellowship comes right there. I'm going to talk about why to do it, when to do it, what may be the best time to do it, what subspecialty to choose, where do you plan to do it, and how to go about it. And first of all, why should we do it at all? Because it kind of broadens the horizon. In wherever you train in India, you are like a frog in the well. You know exactly what your mentors do, you know exactly what your institution does, but beyond that, there is a lot of new knowledge that needs to be acquired, and that actually happens during your international fellowship. It also widens your perspective. The way you think about life and things and ophthalmology changes quite a bit when you get that exposure. So you start thinking differently and start doing differently, and that is a major advantage you'll have over your peers. And also you find a focus area. Diffuseness is a disease, and unless you find something on which you can focus, it's difficult to access. Everybody does cataract surgery, but what are you doing that is different from what others are doing is what is important. Same with oculoplasty, same with retina. Do you have that extra edge over you? So fellowship is all about, international fellowship is all about passion and focus. Other reasons why you should do it is that it will open many doors which were otherwise shut. You know, if you look for a job, certain organizations or institutes may not have one for you. But if you have done an international fellowship under a good mentor, those jobs might just open up for you. More important is that if you do an international fellowship, you find mentors and they generally keep you for life. Mentors who are actually there during your fellowship, you maintain that relationship all through your life. As part of international fellowship, you get a lot of access to data and you can do a lot of research, come out with manuscripts, learn how to go about research, and you have unrestricted access to library services. That means you can get any article, any book free of charge, because all these are very well-stocked libraries, so there is no restriction and there is no dearth. And you also learn how to document, how detailed is the way they document things. It's not on a piece of paper that is given away to the patient. Every patient either has a paper record like this, which is highly detailed. Every part of the tumor is measured here. Every part of the tumor is localized. Every small detail picked up. Everything is photographed. Even in a digital format, they do the same. So this becomes a habit. So when you come back, you start documenting your cases exactly like that. So at the end of it, you stand away from the crowd. You have that particular edge on top of what you are already acquired in India. So what is the best time to do it? I would say after a clinical fellowship in India. If you start doing an international fellowship right after your residency, then you're not in a position to get the best out of a fellowship program. So after a clinical fellowship in India is the best time. So how well can you do it? First one would be an observer. Observer is something between 1 to 4 weeks, and you only observe in OPD and OR. You're not allowed to scrub or assist. It can be a dipstick test before a long-term fellowship. That means if you're confused as to whether to do in a particular institute or another, or if you haven't even decided about a focus area, then if you go to a conference, for example, ASRS or AO, you might want to spend a week or a couple of weeks in several departments before you decide as to what is actually something that excites you. A short-term fellowship is between 3 to 6 months. One way of doing short-term fellowship is to do an ICO fellowship. This is very easy to get, but this is generally not, ICO fellowship is funded, of course, but other short-term fellowships are not funded. So that is a disadvantage. So unless you have money to spare, you may not be able to do short-term fellowship unless it is funded by ICO. While observership can be done with tourist fellowship, some of the institutions demand J1 or a long stay visa for short-term fellowship. You have to be ready for it. The processing actually takes 3 to 4 months for J1 with a lot of paperwork. So short-term fellowship has the disadvantages that it is not paid, and also visa processing takes longer. Long-term clinical fellowship is of two types. One is with USMLE or with USMLE exemption. In two states of US, USMLE is exempted. One is California and the second one is Pennsylvania. Both are extremely large and good states and a lot of institutes. So if you want to do with USMLE exemption, you have to choose these two states. In California, San Francisco and Los Angeles and San Diego are the three hubs for fellowship. Whereas in Pennsylvania, you have Philadelphia and Pittsburgh. So all the universities and hospitals in these areas can exempt you from USMLE, so that is very nice. And you can also, third way of doing it is non-USMLE international fellowship, which is not highly clinical. It is more of observership assistance. You can scrub up and assist, but you're not allowed to operate too much. And for a long-term clinical fellowship, you have to have a strong CV and recommendation. These are not the routine recommendation that we are used to in India, but actually are good reference letters, good quality evaluative reference letters. So these are highly competitive positions, and these can be done in any specialty of your choice, including retina, surgical retina, oculoplasty, ocular oncology, etc. These three are relatively easier to get. Pediatric ophthalmology, strabismus, neuro-ophthalmology and ophthalmic pathology are fairly easy to get. Now, where to do it, that actually doesn't depend on you too much, because you can only choose 5 or 6 organizations. Beyond that, you have to apply for what is called SF match. if you are going to go through the route of USMLE, then SF Match is a service through which you have to apply for fellowship. When you open up the SF Match website, you find that there's a small fee, $320 for the application process, but you have to have your USMLE scores before you apply. And timeline is like this. It takes exactly 1 year. That means that if you start the process in July 2020, you are ready to join fellowship in July 2021. So you have to be ready for this. So some who are very keen to do it, start applying when they are doing an Indian fellowship, or just about the same time that joining an Indian fellowship, they start applying for SF Match, because it takes about 1 year. What beyond SF Match, if you have USMLE and you still want to apply, then you have to look for positions which suddenly become open. Like these are ready to start. These are beyond the match. February 2020, this particular position was open, medical retina fellowship. In the same month, a long-term vitreo retina surgical fellowship was open. So these are beyond the match. These are very easy to get. These are immediate openings. Generally, fellowship starts on 1st of July. But this is starting in February, because obviously the previous fellow has left or discontinued for some reason. So a position has become vacant. Now for July 2020, you have uveitis fellowship in three organizations. Mass and Air is a wonderful place to work, and it is a post-match vacancy. So if you have your scores, you can apply there and get in immediately. Similarly, glaucoma fellowship in July 2020. So if you have USMLE already, then SF Match is the way to go. Now, if you don't have USMLE and you still want to do a clinical fellowship and you want to do it in states which are not exempt, then you have to go through the international route. Some of the organizations offer international fellowship, and you can see this is an older version of the website that I have taken a screenshot from, but they give all the information, then you can go through it. In Canada, there are two major universities, University of British Columbia and University of Toronto, which offer good fellowship. Most important thing to remember about Canada is that there is no exam to clear. But if you have FRCS, Edinburgh, Glasgow, that is preferred. But you still have to clear the English language examination, that is IELTS score of more than 7. And the information is given on the website. This is University of Toronto website. It lists all the fellowships that are possible, clinical fellowships that are possible. These are little less competitive than American fellowships, and these are easier to get, and most of these are headed by people of Indian origin. So you have that immediate connect with them. And this is, again, information that is available in the website. All they ask for is full fluency in English language. There is nothing else required. This you can prove using your IELTS score, and you have to have completed an Indian postgraduate degree before you go for this. But if you have completed your clinical fellowship, then you stand a much better chance in the interview. This is from University of British Columbia. Again, requirements are the same. There is no special requirement, and most of these fellowships are listed in the Canadian Ophthalmological Society website. This is the kind of Excel sheet that you get when you go and search through Canadian Ophthalmology Society. You can get a listing depending on the university and based on the fellowship subspecialty. And the duration is written here, number of spots are written here, and the name of the mentor who you can directly contact. So there is no organized fellowship application process in Canada. You contact the mentors directly, and you can look at the number of slots that are available. Tremendous. So there is a huge opportunity for doing fellowship in Canada. So what about research fellowship? You can do it anytime. These are relatively easy to get. There are certain named research fellowships that you can apply through ARVO. ARVO has a lot of information about it. Otherwise, if you want a very good quality research fellowship, which is generally not funded, but there are about scholarships for about 20% of applicants, is the International Research Training Program at Harvard Medical School. This is an Ivy League university, and some of these programs are combined with a PhD as well. So this is a wonderful way of doing a research fellowship. And if you go through this website, you get the name of the professor who is offering this slot and the name of specificity of the research area. For example, this is diabetic eye disease research fellowship that this particular person is offering. So you get the entire list, and if something matches with your focus areas, suppose your exam, you're interested in dry eye diseases and one of the mentors is doing research on that area, you can readily apply and hopefully you'll get it. The chance of getting a research fellowship in this program is, I believe, about 50-50. For every two applicants, one gets it, which is a very fair number. And on top of that, if you get funding, that is wonderful. Now, international fellowships in UK has a long haul, but it is fairly easy to get. It is not difficult. So first thing you have to do is to shortlist the fellowship program. And to shortlist the fellowship program, you have to go through this website. It's called idocs.co.uk. And again, you get this Excel sheet where the specialty is listed, the place of fellowship is listed, and the supervisor's name is listed, duration is listed, and the contact number is listed. So all the information is given, and you directly apply. There is no intermediary here. So first step is to apply for the fellowship position, generally which is about 6 months to 9 months before the position starts. Now, if you want to look for jobs, there is one more website that's called NHS Jobs. This is also jobs, actually doesn't mean work always, it also means a fellowship job. And when you look for it, you'll find positions like this. This post-CCT fellowship is for those who are trained in UK. This is not applicable to us. But what you can apply for is clinical fellow hire in ophthalmology in a particular subspecialty. For example, this is in Cambridge. Now for this, either you have to have a FRC of part 2 or equivalent. Equivalent is MD or MS from India is an equivalent. So you qualify to apply. So once you have applied, you might have a Zoom interview or a tele interview. You may not have to go to UK to give this interview. Then if you have got this position, so first is to apply. If you have got that position, then you apply for IELTS and clear it. That is your English language specification. They prefer overall score of more than 7.5 and a minimum of 7 in each area, that is reading, listening, writing and speaking, which is not difficult to prepare. You can prepare within a week to crack it. The next step is for GMC application. That's General Medical Council application. There are three ways of getting a GMC registration. One is PLAP test, which we all know. The second and the easier part is sponsorship. Otherwise, you have to have approved postgraduate qualification. So in GMC apply, you have to decide the route first. If you want to take PLAP, then you have to go through PLAP in part 1 and part 2. If you want to go through dual sponsorship scheme, which is easy, you have to have a UK sponsor first. Basically, whoever has given you a fellowship slot will be your UK sponsor. Your medical college professor will be your Indian sponsor, or whoever, your fellowship mentor will be your Indian sponsor. That is it. Sponsorship does not entail any money sponsorship. It's just a sponsor who will vouch for your qualifications. Otherwise, you can have a primary UK sponsor and an Indian sponsor and a secondary UK sponsor. This is for a junior primary UK sponsor. You need a secondary UK sponsor as well. The third way to get GMC registration is to have approved postgraduate qualification, which can be either FRCS Edinburgh, Glasgow, MRCS Glasgow or MRCS Edinburgh. So if you have gone through the ICO route, you get the MRCS straight away. So that is one way of getting your GMC license. Now, once you've got your GMC license, you have to apply for visa. You could get either a Tier 2 visa or a Tier 5 visa. These are just nomenclatures. There's hardly any difference between the two. Payment is the same. But with Tier 5, if you have to convert to Tier 2 later for job purposes, you have to come back to India and then apply. So that's it. So basically, GMC registration is the limiting factor for a UK visa and UK fellowship. And well, it is, takes time, but it is possible. In Australia and New Zealand, again, you don't have to pass a qualifying examination currently. You simply have to apply, and the slots are available in the RANSCO website. This is the RANSCO website, which you can search and get the available positions and straight away apply to your mentors, and they will give you a temporary license without having to clear an exam. But if you want to stay back there, you have to clear exams. In Singapore, you have SNEC and National University. SNEC has very clearly demarcated overseas fellowship. This is also available through AIOS. In fact, AIOS ARC interviews and finds five best youngsters. to and sponsors them for an international fellowship in SNEC Singapore. Though these are 5 slots every year. But beyond that, you can directly apply and get it. I know several young PGs who have gotten by themselves without any sort of having to pass an exam or any other via media. ICU Fellowship is, Dr. Grover may elaborate a little bit, but ICU Fellowship is an extremely good opportunity, but this is just a 3-month fellowship. It's called a fellowship, but it's in an observership. It can be a preparation for a long-term fellowship. ICU website gives all the details. And finally, if you're not a clinically oriented person, if you want to do something in community ophthalmology, there are wonderful opportunities. Most of these are paid fellowships. London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine is one. Second is Center for Community Ophthalmology in University of California and Harvard and Johns Hopkins. Hobbies used to offer international fellowships, but no longer now they offer staff ophthalmology position. This was me during my fellowship. So basically, I think my life changed after international fellowship. So that's why I'm very keen that every bright youngster who has passion and focus does it at some point in time or the other. Thank you.
Thank you. It was instructive. Really illustrative, sir.
Thank you.
As we begin to understand what, how, and where to pursue ahead, clouds of confusion begin to disappear. But one often ponders over FRCS. To weigh the pros and cons and answer the question, is FRCS useful? We have yet another amazing speaker, Dr. Rashmin Gandhi, sir. Sir.
Ritu, please wait 2 minutes.
Thank you, Santosh. Thank you, Santosh. This was really a very elaborate and a list of the international fellowships available. We are all knowing about the Indian fellowship we have posted in Indian General Ophthalmology. You could also post this fellowship available internationally in Indian General Ophthalmology. It will be very good for the PGs. Okay. All the PGs, they can note down the fellowship. They will be available on the Facebook and YouTube, because you people all are busy in exam now today, preparing for the exam nowadays, we know. So you can see all the fellowship in the Facebook and YouTube for today. Yes, sir, Rashmin.
Sir, first we take a lot of questions.
Impact, ask later on. There are a lot of questions. We will ask them later on.
Okay.
Rashmin? Right. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Dr. Deepak, Dr. Satanshu, for this opportunity. And you have crafted the program very well, and I'm extremely happy to be part of this program. So after looking at what to do after post-graduation and what all opportunities are available, let's now look at one more area of interest for a lot of us as to what are these ICO and FRCS exams. I'll touch upon a little bit about the ICO exams as well. And should you be considering, now you are completing your post-graduation, you are preparing for your exam, so should you be considering to write the FRCS exams or the ICU exams at this juncture? Most of you, most of the postgraduates in India start writing the ICU while they are in the postgraduate residency program, because that's the right time. The ICU exams would have a basic science component, a reflection component, a clinical science component, and an advanced exam. And a lot of the right time to write the basic science exam is during the postgraduation, because you would have read about the basic sciences and reflection during your post-graduation. But even if you have not written, and if you want to write the ICU exam, any time is a good time. Now, why would you like to write the ICU exam? Now, in a country like India, where we have a fairly standardized programs and exams better than a lot of other countries, ICU exam is an additional standardized international exam. It does not give you any other benefit apart from writing an additional standardized international exam. If you pass all the components of ICU exam, then you can write, you are entitled to write FICO, acronym behind your name. So that's one advantage. And it is a fairly well-structured exam. Dr. Grover, sir, has been part of ICU very long, and he has been advising ICU and has started quite a few international fellowships and exams for ICU. And probably we'll have a discussion with him at the end of it. But so that's one reason why you would consider writing ICO, that it's a fairly standard good exam. Number two, as Santosh mentioned, there are these ICO fellowships. Now, please remember, these ICO fellowships are a good way to get an exposure to big universities like Harvard, Johns Hopkins, and other universities. And though the website mentions that it is not compulsory for you to have ICO exams passed for you to apply or to be considered for ICO fellowships, but if you have passed these exams, then it helps ICO to apply for and to get selected for ICO fellowship. These exams would help. Now, ICO exams are all MCQ exams as of now, and there's a very clear-cut way of preparation. For example, for basic science, you can read the books that you would have read for your MS or DNB. There is an MCQ book called John Ferries, and that used to be the main book for ICO basic sciences. It has the MCQs which are on the pattern of the exam, which is governed by ICO, and it has an explanation. So it's a good preparatory book, John Ferries MCQ book. If you have to read the textbook apart from Khurana, which a lot of us read during our Khurana's textbook, apart from that, then there is a textbook of basic science by John Forrester, which also may be useful. Now, refraction, clinical sciences, generally the books that you would have read, Elkington and other books, are good enough for your ICO exams. Now, please remember, as of now, ICO, any parts, it does not have any practical exam. You don't have any encounter with the examiner. And as per the latest information, if you have cleared all parts of ICO, you are also entitled to have MRCS from the Royal College of Surgeons of Edinburgh. So that's about the ICO. Now let's come to FRCS. FRCS effectively are being conducted by two colleges which are very popular in India. One is Royal College of Surgeons and Physicians, Glasgow, and the other is Royal College of Surgeons, Edinburgh. These are two most popular FRCS exams. Right now, Royal College of Surgeons of Edinburgh is going through a transition, and it is not very clear as to when and how they will now grant the FRCS. They are now again taking the route of MRCS, and we'll come to it a little later. The other exams which are being conducted by the Royal Colleges are FRCOF, which is conducted by Royal College of Ophthalmologists in London. Another exam which is not very popular in India is the Royal College of Surgeons Ireland, also conducts the FRCS exams. So that's about, these are the colleges which conduct these FRCS exams. Now the question is, why would you? You have completed your post-graduation and you're looking for fellowship, you're looking for a job. Why would you like to consider writing an exam which is fairly expensive to write, and the preparation is quite different from what we would have prepared for our Indian exam? What are the benefits? So these are potential benefits. It is known that once you go through the grind of preparation for the Royal College exams, you would feel that your clinical skills have improved. I'll give some examples for it. Does it help in India in any way if you've cleared your FRCS? Does it help in UK? And part of it was covered by Santosh in his wonderful talk. And what about the role of FRCS in the other countries? So let's look at clinical skills. Why do I say that if you prepare well for the Royal College exams, then it will definitely, you will find that your clinical skills, your practice in the OPD has become better. The reason why I say that is because there are a lot of points, and as KP also mentioned in his talk, that a lot of times our way of approaching a subject is that we would have given you the diagnosis and we would have said that, okay, right, 1, 2, 3, 4, what are the causes of cystoid macular edema, for example. Now, in a Royal College exam, generally, they will construct a question in such a way that you would have to apply the knowledge or the reading that you would have had during your post-graduation. That's the difference. One, it generally tests the application of your knowledge. And second, it gives a lot of importance to the sight-threatening and a vision-threatening comorbidities of any clinical situation that you would encounter in your practice. It would be clinical situation or the treatment of clinical situation. Let's take an example. And I would be very happy if one of the postgraduates who is also a panelist would tell me what he or she is seeing. Here is a patient. What is the first impression? You can see a left eye ptosis, right?
Yes.
You can see a myelitosis in the left eye. Now, let's see if the video, I'm going to check the motor. Tell me, what do you see? Patient looking to the left, Now this is patient looking to the right. And so let me show you again. Here you can already see one sign here, patient looking to the right. Anybody?
Widening of palpable fissure.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So what do you think is happening here?
But in the right eye, there is a narrowing of the palpebral fissure, and in the left eye, there is widening of palpebral fissure.
Now, very right, very good. So if I show you only this picture, you would say that there is a narrowing in one eye and there is widening in the other eye. Excellent. Now, you know that when you started, patient had a ptosis in the left eye. So in all probability, probably you're looking at the left eye as an abnormal eye. Now, if I say that, yes, left eye was an abnormal eye and this is what you observe, any thoughts on it? So let me give you a background. Patient had a paralysis of the third nerve, which recovered. And so little bit of ptosis has remained. And this is the clinical picture that you are still seeing. Now, these are the little things that is given a lot of importance in the Royal College exams. Why? So what you're seeing right now is there is a widening of the palpebral fissure when the patient is adducting this left eye. Where, in which condition would you see a narrowing of the fissure? When the patient adducts the eye? Duane syndrome, absolutely right. He's right. So in Duane syndrome, you'll have narrowing of the fissure when that eye is adducted. Here it is inverse. So this is called inverse Duane syndrome. And this is a sign of aberrant regeneration of the third. Now, why this is given so much importance is because aberrant regeneration of third nerve is almost never seen in third nerve palsy, which occurs because of ischemia. So this is always a sign of a traumatic third nerve palsy or a compressive third nerve palsy. And that's the reason why it's such a subtle sign. But in FRCS, you will end up seeing this picture somewhere, either in the Viva or in your clinical exam, or it will be asked in one of the exams. So the reason why it is given so much of emphasis is that it's a subtle sign, but it is generally seen in a compression of the third nerve, and compressive lesion, the commonest compressive lesion of the third nerve is an aneurysm, which is a potentially life-threatening problem. So that's the reason why when you prepare for FRCS exam, you would go through all these associations which are subtle, but which would be either life-threatening or sight-threatening, and that makes you a better clinician. Let me give you one more example. So here, let's see, patient looks to the left, looks to the right, there is a clear widening of the palpebral fissure, right? Now this is another example. Say you are managing a patient with thyroid-related orbitopathy. Patient has hyperthyroidism and he is on treatment for hyperthyroidism, and you are managing the orbitopathy. He comes to you for a follow-up of orbitopathy and he tells you that I have been having some cough. Would you be able to tell me as to what thoughts are crossing your mind, and how would you deal with this? He's saying, I'm having cough for the last few days. Of course, in the present times, if somebody says cough, you will shoo him away. But let's say in non-COVID times, patient tells you that he's having cough. Anything comes to your mind? So this is another example. Because if you write the Royal College exam, you would have gone through this scenario. You are supposed to prepare for it. So what examiner is trying to tell you here, or what he wants to know, is that would you avoid this complaints of cough that patient has? The reason in this scenario would not ignore it is because anti-hyperthyroid medications can cause disturbance with, it can cause leukopenia, neutropenia, agranulocytosis, and any of these can present with cough as the first symptom, because then when you have depletion of your white blood cells, you're more susceptible to infections. So patient will come to you with cough, and in patient who is already on anti-thyroid medication, you will not ignore it. You go ahead and ask for the white blood cells. If they are gone down, you will talk to a physician or endocrinologist and say, how do you manage it? Because if you ignore it, then it can be life-threatening. Patient can have infection, and because the defense mechanism is very poor, patient can have infection, which can be fairly severe, can become very severe, or which can be fatal. So that these are examples which tells you that because they give so much of emphasis on vision-threatening and life-threatening problem, so many of these subtle things that we sometimes don't read or we ignore or we avoid during our Indian exams, here it's, the emphasis is given, and that makes you a better clinician. Now, what about any other direct benefits in India? A lot of fellowships, and we'll hear about it from Vivek, who's going to talk next, but I would assume that a lot of interviews, the faculty, if he sees that you have written FRCS and you are at par with somebody else, there is a possibility that you might be given a little weightage because you have proven to the organization or to the faculty, to the interviewing board, that you have an inclination for an academic pursuit. Because you have written an exam, which is not compulsory for you to write, but you have gone ahead and written an exam and you have passed it, an exam which is fairly standardized and has all these nuances, and you have passed it, so probably you would be given a little weightage if you are at par with somebody who does not have FRCS. Around a decade ago, these qualifications, you would not be able to register with MCI, so it was just your title, but you would not have any other benefits, but now you can register your FRCS with Medical Council of India as an additional qualification. You still may not have any advantage in applying for a government job, but at least you have a qualification which can be registered with Medical Council of India. What about you, Ken? Santosh has already touched upon it. If you have FRCS, then you become eligible to be to register with General Medical Council, which is an equivalent of the Medical Council of India. If you get registered, you would get some of these jobs, the staff grade jobs, the associate jobs, or a locum job, or if you have a registration and if you have a platform, you probably would be able to do even a fellowship. But if you want to stay back in UK and want to rise in the UK system, want to become a consultant in the UK system, then FRC off, the fellowship of the Royal College of Ophthalmologists, would be more desirable, and it has a very different route from the FRCS, which is offered from the other colleges. So if you want to stay back in UK and become a consultant, then you should take a FRC off the route. Otherwise, to enter UK at a particular level, FRCS is good enough. Same holds true for Singapore, and Santosh touched upon it. FRCS would give you an advantage, those Singapore, a lot of fellowships you will get even if you have not done the FRCS, but you cannot become a specialist or a consultant in Singapore even if you've done the FRCS. And now, in fact, Singapore rules of registration to become a faculty there have become even more strict. Same holds true with UAE. Again, around 15 years ago, if you had an FRCS, then you would be entering the UAE at a different level, at a higher level than a non-FRCS candidate. Your level of entry and your pay scale would have been dramatically different if you had FRCS. But now, they don't give weightage to the FRCS which we pass in India. So if you have a plans of going to UAE and be employed there, then FRCS would help you only if you have cleared it in UK or if you have spent time in UK and if you have done this, what is called as CCT, Certificate of Completion of Training in UK. So that's about the FRCS, its utility. As I said, because of its standardization, let me tell you, when the FRCS exam is conducted, there are generally two examiners for Viva and practicals. So when one examiner is asking you a question, the other examiner is silently giving you marks. So even if I am your examiner in FRCS and if I ask you a neuro-ophthalmic question, the other examiner would not be a neuro-ophthalmologist, so he would weigh down. If I have asked you a very tough question in neuro-ophthalmology, because he's not a neuro-ophthalmologist, he would give you marks accordingly. He will have that balancing effect. The other thing is, it is a very objective exam. So there is a structure and examiners are given that structure. Their examiners go through a preparation for to become an examiner. They have to observe an exam and then become an examiner. So they have a clear route and a philosophy of the exam is clearly taught to them. And at the end of the day, all examiners sit down and then they go through each of the results. And if there is an outlier, if there is a result which is just a borderline, they go and discuss it. So a chief examiner would have a discussion saying that, okay, this is the reason why this guy is just about failing. Should we push him towards pass, or we cannot push for pass? So that kind of a very standardized exam is another reason why you should be writing. And I'm happy to say that Dr. Grover is one of the examiners for many, many years. In fact, when I wrote my FRC exam, Dr. Grover was my examiner. And so he also, I'm sure, would add a few details to it. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Rashmin. Thank you very much. Deepak, you have a few questions to them. You ask the questions from the link.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. First question is for the Santosh Anwar, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, there is question that is any distant fellowship available, international fellowship available in this COVID area?
Well, even if you get it, you can't travel. You can't travel unless you go by a,
No, no. I think what virtual, he meant was
virtual international
virtual virtual
virtual fellowship is not available. You can do a virtual course. You can write a research methodology course or something of that sort, but you can't have virtual fellowship.
So one question for you, Santosh.
Yeah.
Best fellowship. What is the scope of International Council of Theology (ICO) with regards to fellowship abroad? I think you already told them. You have already told them about the ICO.
Correct. ICO is relatively easy to get. I don't know of anybody who hasn't got it, but all they need to show is that they have a focus area. They have to write their application well. They have to write, they have to have a good letter of recommendation by their sponsor. And it's very easy to get.
So, Meet Parikh, I think you have got the answer. Dr. Mashiru, answer.
I'll add something. Right?
Yes, sir.
If you pass the exams, it adds definite marks to that. You have an evaluation process, which is fairly objectivized. So, it is almost 25 marks, which makes it really much easier to get through. Secondly, you need to show that you are needed at home and that you will come back and probably multiply the effect by being in a teaching position. So if you say that you have a proof that you will get back to India and do some good work, help create a subspecialty and teach others, then you definitely will be a preferred person for the fellowship. And you need to have a prior approval from an institution where you want to do the fellowship. So if you write to those people who are on the list and have an approval letter from them, it makes it much, much easier. After the preliminary form entry, then you are eligible to ask the people who are on the list, choose your person, get an affirmative answer, and then apply.
Dr. Grover is in the on the FRCS and ICO, both the examinership. So you people are lucky, all the PGs are lucky to have him as your chairperson. KP, there is a question for you.
Yes, sir.
You are the teaching in the department. Will making notes help in final exams?
Teaching the?
Will making notes help in final exams?
Of course.
Dr.
Notes.
Should you prepare the notes in the exams?
Notes. No. Yeah. Obviously, I think not just this. See, normally
a lot of online teaching is going down nowadays.
No. Notes are very important.
When you write down in your own handwriting, probably it's easy to read. Probably that will be a capsule format, so you can cover more things in a short time. So when you are really doing the last few days of your exam, I think notes will always make a sense. But no point starting the making notes making 15 days to the exam. It has to happen all three years.
Dr. KP, one more question to all of the chairpersons and the panelists. Very important. In COVID-19, operative procedures are restricted. So how to teach the residents to get the surgical skill? What they
I think I will start. This is an extraordinary situation. See, in a place where we had a very robust surgical training and residency training.
Still more ahead. We have
so now we don't have community-based camps. So charity work is not happening. So that has affected the surgical training. But nevertheless, I told you I had to look for an opportunity in adversity. So you will have to probably make your theory stronger, learn from your clinical acumen, and probably you have to concentrate on your wet lab training. Now, this is a time to innovate on your wet labs. I think wet lab training has to probably bridge the gap.
By the time things make a turnaround and then you start having camps, probably that is the way. I think everything as, I mean, what is happening in the world, even the surgical training of residents have taken a hit. I think slowly we will probably limp back to normalcy.
There's a proposal to call this a 0 year and then extend the terms of residency and fellowship. So that may be.
So I thought they're going to be passed without exam. You said you are extending.
Santosh, they want to, all the PGs get want to pass. They will learn the surgical training later on. They want the degree first.
Another question is that, sir,
what do you advise? How they should learn during this time?
I think they can look at a lot of YouTube surgeries. There are excellent surgeries by Santosh and several other people on the net. So you can maybe get oriented a lot better, do work in the wet labs, and there are simulators. If you can get access to them in some of those centers which have them, All India Ophthalmic Society is also planning to have a simulator at some stage or the other for the phaco emulsification and build setup at the headquarters. So, if you get an access to that, that can be helpful. Otherwise, I think strengthening of wet lab is an opportunity that we can take at this stage and create one till the normalization of situation takes place.
Yes. Sir, another question is for the Santosh sir. Sir, one of the PG from Dibrugarh, he want to know that, sir, we are from such a area, from how can we get the recommendation letter for international fellowship by the stalwarts?
No, it doesn't mean they never ask for letters from stalwarts or anything of that sort. They want an honest letter from your mentor. That's it. You know, true and honest letter. What are your capabilities? What are your positive points? What are your negative points? It's not a recommendation letter. It's a letter of reference.
But suppose recommendation reference are required everywhere.
PG teacher from their center.
Yeah, that's right. Whoever is the thesis guide or the head of the department.
Yeah, that's true.
I think one has to make sure that you have no disadvantage today for being from a small town or a city. And yes, one gap that has been bridged by technology. And being a small town boy myself.
Sir, I am also from a small town.
All my schooling was in small towns and yeah. I got
to know. So looking so many small town boys, I think it is better to be in a small town. Making it to the top.
Rashmin?
Yep.
Rashmin, there's a question for you. How to prepare for interview or fellowship after residency? Madhuri from Mumbai.
We are going to have a talk on fellowship to Vivek, but let me tell you, there are two aspects of most of the fellowship across India. One is your CV. So if you applied for a cornea fellowship and if your CV shows clearly that your inclination is towards cornea, you've presented or you've worked on cornea or your thesis is on cornea, you have a publication on cornea, that will be a huge advantage. And then second is always the interview and the letter of reference. In the interview, if you're able to prove to examiner that one subject that you have applied for, you really want to have a fellowship in that subject. Second, a lot of interviewers in the institutions like to learn that you want to do fellowship only in that institution, and that always gives you an advantage. We had a fellow who came back third time saying, I only want to do fellowship only in your institution. And then that went as one, his persistence and his zeal to work in Shanganitrala went for him.
KP sir, one question for you. What are the options after the post DOMS other than secondary DNB?
I think the fortunately now this question probably will not haunt in future, only the present batch which is to completing the DO. See, I think DO means do. That means you have to do DNB. Okay. Or there are institutions which will take you for fellowship because logistically, the amount of ophthalmic training is so vast, so demanding. 2 years, they always waste three months in coming in only, and they get relieved 3 months before. So it's hardly, 1.5 years. You probably can't do justice to ophthalmic training. Even you under the best mentorship, best setup also. So I think that is a very impractical thing. So I think once you finish your DO, you have a gun. You have a license. Okay. But only thing is now you need to learn how to use the gun better. So you can always do a training. I think never stop at DO. There are many examples. People have made it big with DO with their sheer effort and the kind of innate acumen. But training probably has to be done. So nobody should stop at DO if they are really aiming high.
He can do comprehensive ophthalmology fellowship with built-in FRCS, which
is available. Yes. Some training has to be done.
KP, there's a question from Dr. Firdaus Anandpur. Are the fellowship this year going on? You are giving fellowship years?
Yes. Only thing is we have deferred, delayed the entry point because the fellowship has got, you know, these 2-3 months. But otherwise, we are coming in around in the end of July or August, we are actually recruiting fellows.
Some organizations are not doing it this year. And some exams are also not over. No? MS exams are postponed. So.
Yeah.
Yes. Santosh sir, one question for you, not from this webinar, but another one. Dr. Purva want to ask from Bhopal, what is the treatment of post-inflammatory pseudotumor?
She's taking her exams. So you can follow Rashmin's criteria.
You will answer it tomorrow.
Yeah. Santosh, somebody is asking if we have to crack the fellowship LVPI. He coming from a peripheral institute, not a big name of the institute, not the big name of the professor is studying there. How to crack it?
You don't have to be a big name. LVPI fellowship exam is extremely honest and straightforward. Nothing else goes in except merit, and they have to do the theory well to get to the interview first. Theory is not difficult. These are clinically oriented questions. I think currently there are two levels of screening. One is preliminary screening where online exams are held, and the secondary is screening where personal test and interview are held. Interview is also very honest. They don't ask too much of theory information, but they want to assess the attitude. Attitude and aptitude are assessed more than knowledge, and those are the two most important ingredients to kind of get into LVPI.
Dr. Renu, we can invite the next speaker, Dr. Deepak, then we can have question later on.
Just one question.
Yeah.
Because they have mentioned it to the name of the sir. Now, from where we get the resource material are the MCQs for FRCS or teaching abroad or training abroad?
So the FRCS, the books are the same. It's the way you prepare and way you give your answer is different. So the books, whatever basic book that you're reading, Yanov or AO series or Kansky, should be good enough for your clinical part. The basic science, there's a list given on all Royal College books websites, and that should be good enough.
Rashmin and Dr. Grover, sir, I will give you advice, sir. You should start an institute or giving, but good doctor is asking how to get hands-on in fellowship, how to win different mood, temperament of mentor and the fellowship examination. Why can't we start a institute where we can give a training just like position training? How to get the fellowship? We can
meet the mentors or students.
How we can take the interview? Dr. Priti is asking this question.
No, you want to train the mentors or students?
Mentors.
Rashmin, once you start it, I'll apply for a job.
Dr. Grover sir, everyone can join for 1 month and they can learn how to appear in the exams.
I think we are already doing a course for 2 weeks. Dr. Sabyasachi and Rashmin and I and several other people are associated with that course, which is done every year for FRCS training particularly. And
How the students can join your...
We have FRCS ICU module also where we have 4 hours devoted in iFocus every year. So these are the two appointed courses for FRCS and ICO. The one which is done in Bombay, the Lakshmi Institute, they will advertise it on Facebook and on the website. This year probably will not have it, but early next year we'll have it, February or March.
Thank you.
Maybe sir, one question for you, that is the last question. Why not you write the textbook on the refraction? Residents are much more interested in refraction. And your live classes of the
I think we have got busy after post-COVID lockdown. I think I should have got this, 3 months before. I could have done something, but still, I will try to, you know, honor them probably very soon. Thank you so much for the advice.
I would prefer KP live much more than a
textbook.
Sir, you will write the preface.
Please invite the next speaker.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir.
Okay, Dr. Satanshu.
Yeah.
Me and Dr. Santosh have to join the next webinar if you are all okay with it.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much for the opportunity. Okay.
Santosh, thanks a lot. KP, thanks a lot to both of you. Always helpful to guide us our PGs.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Santosh.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you for an insightful and beneficial question answer session, sirs. Now we are all set and we are ready to embark a new journey with all the knowledge in our little heads. But to test the ability that we can use that knowledge, we are going through interviews. For that, we have our last impressive speaker of the day, Dr. Vivek Dave, sir, and he is here to hand over some tips needed for fellowship interviews. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Ritu. Hope I'm audible.
Yes, you are.
Very well, Vivek.
Yeah, thank you. So, thank you for the opportunity, Dr. Mishra and Dr. Mathur. I'll just share my screen now. And just again, please confirm for me that the screen is visible.
It is visible, sir.
All right. So, good evening, everyone. I'll be taking you through fellowship interviews. I will take a step back and discuss a bit of how you approach it before the actual interview. What are the things that one looks at during the interviews and a bit beyond, just sort of a touch on how you start off your first leg of a fellowship when you get through. Vivek Dave, am currently a vitreoretina surgeon at the LVPI Institute at the Hyderabad campus. Now, I talk to you today with some amount of background with respect to education at LVPI. I have had a 2-year stint as the campus in charge at LVPI Hyderabad for education. Also, I've been on the panel for our retina fellowship selections on multiple occasions over the last 5 years. And, as I would still consider myself to be in the younger lot, I would say I have a decade of mixing with residents and fellowship aspirants as someone from their generation. So a lot of points that I will actually give you today are those which were imbibed and expressed by the candidates that we saw here at LVPI. And the approaches that struck us, and a lot of them finally did end up getting our fellowships, and in quite a few of them we actually struck gold. So why fellowships at all, if you just take a step back? So I've just arranged point-wise what a typical residency training module in India would encompass. So if you look at the elements in green, they are those which generally any residency program would have, largely speaking, either really good or a little suboptimal place-to-place variation. That would be clinical examination skill, surgical skill, theory knowledge. A little in the yellowish color is that something where the candidate may or may not have too much of an exposure, that is research and teaching. And something which rarely is a part of our training, often even at fellowship levels, is an exposure to administration. That is something which is amiss in most of our training programs. Now, there have been a plethora of studies of the Indian setup by stalwarts in India who have assessed our residency and medical college department training programs. And the gist is that there is a wide variation in quality. Often the surveys have found that there is inadequate supervised training. Many candidates do get a lot of theoretical knowledge, but there is a practical shortfall. And at the end of it, one is left with a feeling of inadequacy that I have spent 3 years in ophthalmology, but still there are so many elements that I am not completely strong at. At the same time, there is a paradigm shift in which practices are done over the world. If you look at a few decades ago, there would be lots and lots of general ophthalmologists. But as the decades have gone by, we see more and more thrust on subspecialty knowledge. as Dr. Hunawar alluded to, there is a thing of diffuseness being a disease. So you have more and more practitioners wanting to concentrate on specific topics and excel in those specific topics. So currently the jack of all trades is not something that one looks at. There is a big thrust on becoming a master of certain specific knowledge. So that is where fellowships do come in. When you're thinking of fellowships, one important question is when, temporally speaking, is it a good time? Well, this is very individualistic. So one needs to answer, what is my intent of doing a fellowship? Am I looking at it just as an additional top-up skill or an additional thing to brush up my knowledge? Say, for example, you are a good cataract surgeon. Now, a new technique has come in, femtosecond surgery. So, am I looking at a femtocataract top-up skill? If that is there, then I can possibly look at it at any time during my practice and it would come out of my practice and do something like that. Or am I looking at a completely new set of skill altogether? Say, for example, residency will give you a lot of exposure to general ophthalmology and cataract, but it really may not give you an exposure to hardcore retina or hardcore oculoplasty. And if those are the things that excite you or those are the things on which you want to build your career, then it is a completely different ballgame. And then rather than it being at any other time of your convenience, it should possibly follow your residency as soon as possible so that you have learned everything that you want to learn before you actually deep dive into your clinical practice. So in general, I would say the earlier the better, because more you get all your training in a particular phase off your back, more you are able to settle down in the other phases of life and your practice as such. So to do or not to do fellowships would depend a lot on what is your passion for pursuing some subspecialty. What is the need for practice? If you are in a particular area, what is the eventual and tentative geographic destination where you are likely to practice? So if you are in a situation where you do not have a particular subspecialty of ophthalmology catered to, you may get a good head start in your practice if you have a fellowship in that particular specialty. So from the interviews, just take a step back and we look at preparations before one actually goes for the interviews. Now, the preparations would begin right from submitting an appropriate CV or an appropriate resume. I will talk of the setups where I have taken interviews, and I am sure you would have similar setups at multiple places. Now, typically at my institute, we would have tens of candidates that we are going through on a given day when we are looking at the interviews. Now, each one will possibly get about 10 minutes or to the max 15 minutes with the panel. That is not really the time where one can extensively go through every element or every aspect of what the candidate has to offer. So it is very important from a candidate's point of view to ensure that you utilize those 10, 15 minutes that you're getting with your panel in an absolute precise way. Give all possible information as lucidly as possible, so that you set a very good impression. So from that point of view, when you are going to come in to the room for the interview, most interviewers will sit with your CV copy before they call you in and browse through it. Now for most of the panel, or possibly the whole panel, this would be the first time that they are seeing the CV copy. It is not that the CV was circulated to them at the moment when you had actually submitted it to the education departments. So your CV needs to be precise. It should not be more than 2 to 3 pages, and you should not give generic ones. Most of us will have one CV copy which is ready with us. It is nice to tailor it to the requirements of the interview or the requirements of the institute where you are applying for. Please ensure that it's the updated one and it has no gaps. Your CV should give a good fluid chronology of where you have been as far as your educational journey is considered, right till fellowship. So there should not be gaps in between which are unaccounted for. Any salient point in terms of achievement or in terms of any tenure that you would have spent at any other place could give brownie points, and they should be nicely highlighted so that they catch the attention of the panel when they're going through your CV. The CV should not be a prose or an necessary. It should be short sentences or bullet points for, you know, immediate capture and recollection for the panel. If you look at the days before the interview, you have submitted your CV, fine, you wait for the date to get announced, the date gets announced. So for a few days before you actually go into the interview, I would advise you the 5 R's. That's research, reach, rehearse, revise, and relax. So research, in terms of what? So I'm not indicating research as in you sit and do some clinical research, but you research about the institute where you are going to go and take your interview. This is very important. You cannot be entering into an institute where you really have no idea about what the place is all about. So most big places which offer fellowships nowadays will have their websites. The websites will have their FAQs. They will have sections like about ourselves. They will have a short section often, which is latest press releases, which may be the hot and happening things with respect to the institute that is really occurring. So go through this very well and ensure that any important point about the institute is not missed. I'll give you an example. There was a question once asked in an interview by one of my co-interviewers, you know, who was L.V. Prasad? So the person came for the L.V. Prasad Eye Institute interview. Fair enough. Is the person's work in future related to who was L.V. Prasad? No. But it really doesn't give a good impression that you are applying for an institute and you don't know who the person is on whom the institute was named. So this is just one example. If you have a good grasp and preparation on these background things, you immediately give an image impression that you know what you are actually getting into with respect to that particular place. Second is reach out. So reach out to past candidates. So you would have, often you would have some senior who's already pursuing a fellowship there, or you would have some known friend who has been there, done that, or gone through that particular interview. So reach out to them, try and get a hang of how the entire process is so as to actually not be caught by surprise. So I'm not saying reach out in terms of exactly know what the questions are asked, because many times questions may change. Some questions are generic, but some may change. But it is for you to be familiar with what process you're going to expect when you're going to go there for the interview. Another R is rehearse. So it's not a bad idea if two or three friends can actually rehearse amongst themselves in terms of conducting a mock interview. You can actually even have any teacher of yours who can spare some time and actually put you through a particular interview. And not really in terms of the content, but in terms of actually being able to speak out well, so that when you are in the interview, you do not stutter and you end up speaking really well with respect to whosoever is there in front of you in the interview. Another thing is revise. So it is important to revise everything that you have put across in your CV. CV is the document that you have already submitted to the panel a few days or weeks before, and everything that you have entered there is fair game for discussion. It is harakiri if you have entered something in the CV that is what is asked or pulled up for discussion and you do not have head or tail about it. This can sometimes happen with certain nuances about your thesis topic, because you would have submitted your thesis some time ago. There may be a few fine points which you may have missed. More often than not, you may have also worked with few of your faculty during residency on a certain manuscripts. You may have helped in data collection. So you may have your name put there as a co-author, but you may not have put too much interest in understanding the manuscript. So your name is there. It's reflecting on your CV. But then when a question is asked about that research work, you draw a blank. So this is something that should not happen. So please be sure that whatever you are submitting as your CV or as your resume, you have a complete grasp over. And last I would say is relax. So do not follow the photographs that I have shown. There have been situations where we have realized that the candidate has, if he is appearing, he or she is appearing for the retina interview, has sat all night and read detailed studies and clinical trials on retina. That is not required, because such interviews ideally are not meant to test how much particular knowledge you are having about that particular topic. But like as one of the speakers mentioned before me, it's more about your attitude or your aptitude. And all of these you things you would be able to express comfortably if you are having a relaxed mind. As far as the day of interview is concerned, if possible, and if the particular institute allows you, try and see if you can visit the center a day prior. This again is not to sort of get some sneak peeks about what is going to happen in the interview, but again to get a flow of familiarity. Maybe a very fine point, but trying to search your way across where the interviews are going to be conducted on the day of the interview and already knowing your path across the place because you had visited the place a day before makes a lot of difference on the psyche in terms of giving you a relaxation due to the familiarity. So see if it is possible. Not all places would allow you, but if there is a possibility, do explore that. Ensure that you are well rested and well groomed, right? You are going to appear for a fellowship interview. You are projecting yourself as a super specialist and a 2B super specialist physician. So it's very, very important that you project a similar image. Ensure that you are on time. Again, small points, but they are something which reduce confusion at the last moment and ensure that you are not stressed out. Now, when it comes to the actual interviews, a lot of you would be surprised when you go in for such interviews that a very small chunk of the questions are usually related to clinical situations, actually. You may have one or two questions which are thrown towards you in terms of the topic, just basically to give or take a feel with respect to your basic understanding of the topic. But most questions are often generic to judge the temperament and the approach of the candidate and not really to test your knowledge, because nobody would be able to test knowledge in a short span of the interview. And most interviews are already preceded by one session where a theoretical exam has already been taken. So whatever amount of theoretical input one needs as an interviewing panel, one already has some sort of an idea. So enter the room with good confidence, with a smile, with your thinking cap on, which again, you would be able to wear only if you're mentally relaxed and have not stressed yourself out the night before. Ensure that you wish everyone, maintain a good posture, don't fidget, and have good eye contact. This is something that I'm again telling you from experience. A lot of candidates really do not tend to maintain eye contact. They are actually looking all around as to what the panel is doing with their papers or with their CV. So it is really good to maintain eye contact. Maintaining eye contact actually gives you an idea that the particular candidate is confident about himself or herself. As you approach the questions, you may find some questions which are tough. You may find some questions which seem like a breeze and seem like literally out of place in the interview. You may feel I'm coming in for a specialty interview and why am I asked something which is generic? But like I told you, these questions are meant to understand your aptitude and attitude. So there are a few questions which you may want to pre-prepare. Again, these are a few which we tend to ask often. And not just at my place, but I have seen a few other places. I have seen a few other interviews being conducted at institutes. And often these questions are a little generic, but give a lot of information about the candidate per se and also the approach of the candidate. So you would be asked, tell us more about yourself. Now, this is something where you should not stutter. So this is something where you need to talk about, what your ophthalmology journey currently has been, what you are looking at going ahead. Why do you want to do this fellowship is also something that would be asked often. Another sort of a trick question that is asked for is, if you have applied for fellowship A, if we offer you fellowship B instead, right, would you be game? So this is again something that you need to answer with respect to your interests. Dr. Rashmin mentioned that there are occasions when you have candidates reapplying because they are very focused. They want a particular fellowship at a particular place. And if they don't crack it, you see them again 6 months later. So that adds a lot of value. There are many candidates who tend to apply for multiple fellowships. Say, for example, if I see a candidate who's applying for cataract refractive fellowship, also for cornea fellowship, and also for glaucoma fellowship, I, as a panel, would have a feeling that that person wants to learn cataract surgery and he wants to get through whichever way is possible. If not this fellowship, then that. If not that fellowship, then the other. But the aim seems to be cataract because that is the only thing which is an overlap between the thing, between the three. Otherwise, all three, in a nuanced sort of a way, are different from each other. So remember, if you can really narrow down to just one or two subspecialty applications, it works really well. Also, if there are two applications, they should not be poles apart. If there's somebody who's applying for cornea and also applying for retina, again, for me, it becomes as the person is not really serious. He's looking for either this or that. So this is something which is important. You would more often than not be also asked about your thesis work and whether you have managed to publish it, because that gives some sort of an insight whether you have a research inclination. Most big institutes offering fellowships nowadays have research as a part and parcel of their fellowship module. And they actually prefer or would like if there is a candidate who already has some amount of heads up as far as research is concerned. You have done your residency from a reputed institute, then why not try there for fellowship? Why us? Now, there is a possibility that you may also have applied to your own institute or certain other institutes. So it is not at all a bad idea, or it is not at all negative to speak that out. If you are categorically asked, have you applied somewhere else? There is no shame or nothing wrong in saying that, yes, I also have applied at XYZ place. That happens to be my second choice, or that happens to be my choice if I do not get through here. So there is no necessity to actually hide that you have applied at any other place. This comes across as an honest point, and honesty, being upfront, always helps in interviews. One question which often, unfortunately, is asked more to females is, are you married or are you planning to get married? And how do you see, that you will balance your family life going ahead? So this is again something which you need to figure out what you are going to answer before you are going to go into a fellowship. And in situations, especially, this is doubly tough for the female candidates, because a marriage or a family life commitment obviously tends to have a little more pressure on the lady as compared to the male candidates. So this is something which you need to sort out before you are entering into a fellowship interview, and you should have things completely delineated as to how you would go about the rigmaroles of a fellowship when you also have a complementary marriage or family, for example, to take care of. So whatever are your arrangements in terms of either your parents or your family planning to move in with you, or be it arrangement of a nanny. So these are some things which should be clear, and you should give a clear cut positive answer as to how you will balance family life. You should not leave this question to conjecture, because the panel should not get an idea or should not get a feeling that if I take in this candidate, it would be a candidate with liability, because there is something else that the candidate is not going to be able to balance. Many a times you will also tend to get a second set of questions if you are doing really well with the basic set, and that would be something which will be a little more philosophical. What do you know about our institute? Can you enlist one weakness and one strength of yours, and how it would affect your fellowship conduct? How would you handle a conflict in case something happens in terms of a conflict during your fellowship? What are your long-term goals? Once you finish your fellowship, how do you see yourself in practice? Do you see yourself in your private practice? Do you see yourself attached to an institute? So these questions are again something where you should not be completely blank about. You may not have a category clear-cut answer, because nobody knows 100% what you're going to do going ahead. But you should have some sort of idea in terms of what are your possible long-time goals. And some of them may end saying that, do you have any question for us? So again, this is something where you can tend to have certain questions ready for the panel. You can possibly give pause, a couple of moments of pause and ask them. I mean, one good question to ask the panel is, the panel says, do you have any question for us, is you could ask them that, you know, as a faculty, what do you think are the strengths and weaknesses of the fellowship that I would go in? Or what do you think are the things that an incoming fellow should concentrate upon? What do you think I should prepare? Suppose, I get through, could you give me a heads up as to what are the things that I would prepare before I actually, present myself on day one of the fellowship? So all of this shows your intent and your eagerness to enter the fellowship, and the fact that you are asking the right questions about preparing yourself to be, selected for the interview, selected for the fellowship. There will be situations where you may be asked clinical questions. You may have answered what you feel is right, but it's possible that the panel may refute you, or the panel may have a different idea. So do not fall into an argument. So always remember, you may be better read, but any panel is in a better stead. You can be assertive, but please do not be, aggressive and fall into an absolute argument. There may be situations where you do not know an answer. I was once asked, what do you like in retina? And I think I said diabetic retinopathy is something that I tend to like, and I would like to pursue further research in diabetic retinopathy in case I get through the fellowship. I was quirkily asked, so where have you done your residency from? I said, RP Center, New Delhi. So next question was, what is the prevalence of diabetic retinopathy in the urban population of New Delhi? I had no answer. So if you don't have an answer, you just say that, this is something that I'm not aware of, and I'll look into it. So it's okay to not know a particular answer, because like I said again, there is no end to the number of clinical or number of objective questions. And at a given time, you may not really be knowing an answer for that particular question. So there is no shame in it at all. So once the interviews are over, ensure that you thank everyone for their time, and also express that it was a pleasure meeting them, and hopefully you'll see them again. So again, it's a passing comment that leaves a very good impression. Trust me, I think we as Indians are not really very good in our social skills of greeting each other. Everyone who has been abroad among the audience would know how in Western countries, when two people cross, even if they are unknown and there is eye contact, there is a small smile or there is a small greeting. So it's always nice to end it that way rather than make it cold and impersonal, as to just stand up, say thank you, sir, and move out of the room. A small snippet on when you make it into the fellowship. So suppose you are all getting through your fellowship interviews, and actually the day comes when you are about to start. Start early so that you are able to stand out. Right. Again, one of the speakers mentioned that the courses can often be short, and you may lose some time before or at the end of it, not really being able to concentrate on learning, especially entering into the institute. It may be a different work culture altogether, and you may lose some time trying to adjust the routine of that place. So before the course starts, if it is possible, approach the educational department of your subspecialty and see for your rotation in terms of the faculty with whom you're likely to get posted. You can very easily find out what are the crucial things that that particular faculty handles in terms of pathologies. So read that up well. Basic theory reading is completely under your control. So ensure that you are well versed with that basic theory of common pathologies that you're likely to encounter in his or her OPD. So what it does is it absolutely escalates the level of discussion that you will have with that faculty. It's like, if I know all about the basic pathogenesis of CSCR, I can quickly escalate discussion with my faculty about newer treatments or about follow-up protocols. So if the base itself is not very stable, then a lot of discussion time would get lost with your faculty at the basic level. So try and clear off whatever you can on your own, so that you can always take in clinical points where you can draw in their experience, because everything else is actually available in books. It also is an indirect indicator to the faculty that you're really interested to deep dive into the topic. See, all your faculty have been in the game for years. for most of them, things have become monotonous. So unless they see a different spark in you, they would also not be really keen to take that extra step forward. So it is like you show them the spark and I'm sure they will, you know, run the mile with you. We often enter training programs thinking about surgery, and with time, most of us have understood, and you all will also understand as residents attempting for fellowships, that it is just not about surgery. Surgery is absolutely one aspect of it. So try to observe, learn, and reflect with respect to how your faculty is conducting himself or herself in the OPD, with respect to interaction with patients, very importantly, with respect to counseling, with respect to follow-ups, with respect to discussions where the cases do well, very importantly, with respect to discussion in cases which do not do well. So these are the things which are really very, very crucial, because surgery, end of the day, is something which is a repetitive task and most of us will get comfortable with time as it is. It is these final nuances that you would like to pick up in your fellowship by taking advantage of your faculty's experience. For the OR, I tend to have a small mental list which I tend to tell fellows, residents, anyone who's posted with me. So if there is an XYZ case on my list, I would 110% want the fellow to know four things about the case before I let that person scrub with me. What is my plan for this patient? So I would want the fellow to go through the sheet, examine the patient, and chalk up his or her clinical management plan, which may or may not be absolutely same with respect to what I have planned for that patient that day. Then a further mental exercise, are there any special requirements in this case? Say, for example, it's a sublux cataract, or say, for example, it's a posterior segment surgery or a cataract surgery where the pupil has been noted not to be dilating. So what will be my special requirement for this case? It would be iris hooks. So are there any special requirements? It's important to get this thinking on so that you do not ask for something random while the surgery is on and then yourself get stressed and, you know, send the staff nurse running around. So if you have already chalked down that these are the two, three things that I will specifically require for this case over and above what is routinely required, then that allows the staff to prepare that and it allows you to be relaxed that that particular thing is available for you at the moment that you require. Next is, what are the difficulties that I would anticipate in a given case? So what would be the difficulties I would anticipate in a small pupil surgery? Say, suppose I am not going to use iris hooks. I would expect a difficulty of the iris getting, you know, entrapped into my phaco probe repeatedly. End of the day, whatever little dilatation is there, that itself may also go. So that is the difficulty anticipated. And how will I tackle it? So I think if you approach every surgical case that you are going to scrub in, be it assisting, be it you yourself operating, and make this a part and parcel of your thought process, it is going to hold you in good stead throughout your career. So know the plan, know if there are any special requirements, know what are the difficulties that you would anticipate, and know how you would tackle them. Also during fellowship, try to look at building your academic portfolio. Keep looking out for interesting cases, case series, retrospective studies. Try to target 2 to 3 case reports or 1 or 2 retrospective series every 6 months. This is of tremendous value because it adds to your CV. See, all of us are going to finish our fellowships as, you know, good surgeons. Now, what is that extra punch that you have over the person who is going to apply for the same job somewhere else? So these are certain things which add to it. And if there is something that has specifically interested you quite early in your fellowship, then you can also take one extra step forward of aligning all your publication efforts towards that particular subtopic. And also, I would say towards the end, prepare to be known in the future. So how do you get yourself known in the future? One thing is getting clinically known by the patients. Another important thing is being known amongst your peers. So for that, you should chalk out important national retinal, I've mentioned retina here, but it could be national subspecialty fora during your fellowship itself. Make your presence felt there. It would be not very difficult if you approach your faculty who would help you with respect to papers or posters or even video presentations. If you do not have those, do attend conferences, but do not sit there as a silent spectator. There are options always available to ask questions. So if not presenting, do ask questions, do interact with the panel once these sessions are over. That not only builds your confidence, but also gives you small, small extra surgical tips, snippets of clinical management. And somewhere when you do that repeatedly, you get noted as somebody who is interested in these activities. Beyond ophthalmology is another important point of fellowship training. Specialty surgeries are varied, and as they are, they also have a background complex administrative process with respect to billing or with respect to insurance, with respect to patient refunds. Fellowships, because you do not really have a pressure of clearing a residency, will also allow you to divert little efforts in understanding processes at the back ends. Most big institutes where you will have good fellowships have a very robust back-end administrative process. So it will be very good for you to understand how these things work, because just operating is one element, but the entire aspect of patient management and administration is something completely different. So in summary, a fellowship doing or not doing is a decision which is a big commitment, comes with it a lot of personal sacrifice. So it has to be a calling. Otherwise, just stopping at residency and a postgraduate itself is enough to actually start a clinical career. But if you have a calling, do go ahead and take that additional step for fellowships. Approach the interviews with good groundwork and confidence. And when a fellowship is begun, assimilate knowledge and disseminate knowledge. As you keep learning, also pass it down to your juniors, which will help you complete that arc of learning and teaching. Attempt to make your mark in the field right from the beginning, wherever you get academic opportunities. And in many of these activities, be it appearing for interviews or be it presenting a competitive paper or a poster, you will get failures. But learn to take these failures in your stride, because given the whole career of ophthalmology ahead, these are just minor small hurdles which you can easily go ahead with. And a last final point of caution, while we do approach or pursue or chase fellowships, please do not lose the big picture. Primarily, we are all ophthalmologists, and we should at least have a track of key diagnoses, especially emerging diagnoses of other specialties. Because with time, as fellowship programs are evolving, you are sort of knowing more and more about less and less. So in that, whatever is out of your core area sometimes falls on the blind spot. So while nuances may fall on the blind spot, it is very important that we don't lose track of real emergencies in the other specialties, so that we can appropriately refer those patients to our other specialty colleagues and ensure that the patient is not harmed. So just to conclude, this is not really a rocket science. You can scientifically and coolly approach a fellowship interview. You require strong basics. More than that, you require self-confidence and a lot of common sense, and it will be as easy as finding X in this diagram. So with good confidence, basics, and common sense, I'm sure most of you will do very well in your fellowships and have a rocking career ahead. So thank you very much for your kind attention.
Vivek, really a very fantastic talk. Each and every minor detail to appear in the interview at the time of fellowship, you have very elaborately told us. I still remember my interview when I went to 30 years back in L.V. Prasad Institute. Dr. Gullapalli Rao and Chandrasekhar were there. They started the institute 2-3 years back only. The same question right. You are telling me now, they asked me not about the L.V., they asked me what about the Hyderabad. What you know? I know. Right. I told one thing only. I know only one thing. L.V. Prasad Institute is in Hyderabad. I don't know anything about the Hyderabad. So they were just laughing. So these two tips you have given it, they are really very important. You should be confident. You should know what you want or what you have come. And everything, nobody can know each and everything. They are just watching your confidence, how you can handle a situation where you don't know anything. So right. You should not lose your confidence. Be prepared, mentally prepared. This, if you do not get this fellowship, this is not the loss of life. You can apply another time. You can apply another place. So, Deepak, any question, Vivek?
Vivek, sir, wonderful talk. Question. There is one question. One of the PG want to know if he is having very little knowledge of surgery, can he apply for LBPI fellowship?
Yeah, absolutely. See, if you have all the knowledge of surgery, then you would not want to apply for a fellowship in the first place. So again, it is not that one is looking for somebody who has all the skills already developed. because we are looking at imparting skills. So please do not feel that if you are from a setup where you have not picked up a lot, you would not be a really good candidate for an LVPI fellowship. In fact, we would be more than happy and would prefer somebody who's from a smaller city, who is from an area where facilities are not available, because in that situation, that person is more likely to learn from here and go back and apply it to a population where that particular training will add value.
Dr. Grover, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
There is a question for you from Delhi only, Akshay Bajaj. Is FRCS or ICU examination any value if one decides to do work in India? Does private hospital give preference to those while hiring them? Is there any value FRCS? Somebody want to apply in the Gangaram Hospital?
Don't look for value in terms of concrete results. It is more for self-validation. Both these exams do not really add anything to your, let's say, material value in terms of job. But they really add confidence to you. They make sure that you have the confidence in your ability and you have tested your ability against an international standard. And well, yes, it may give you a benefit when somebody looks at that and may choose you over somebody else who does not have those qualifications. But basically, it is for your self-validation. And really appreciated Vivek's talk, his attention to detail and his very meticulous approach to the question asked of him. I really enjoyed it.
Thank you.
Vivek, because he has gone through this all these questions, not very far away. When you joined the Vivek, Prasad, how many years back?
Sir. Yeah, I did my fellowship here 2010-11 and I've been here on their faculty since 2014 now.
So whatever he has faced at the time, he is sharing with the next generation.
Still the same generation.
Sir, another question is for our panelist. One of the PG want to know why the payment is so much less in the fellowship and is any way to out of it?
Grover, sir, this is you have to apply it.
See, the fellowship payments are quite variable in different institutions. And essentially, what you have to remember is that it is a training. And that is a sacrifice that you are making by joining the institution. Of course, we do know that there should be a reasonable fellowship, and most institutions have now made them reasonable because a person has to sustain himself, and that's not a stage when you would like to take assistance from your family, financial assistance for a living, if you are alone or even if you are with a family. So definitely we need to improve the amounts of fellowships that are being offered. But at the end of the day, you have to give more value to what you want to achieve through that fellowship at that stage, rather than giving too much consideration to the financial part at this stage.
Our panelists?
I would also like to add, if I may, I would also like to add one point, that you may not just look at it monetarily from the point of view of, how much was paid to you as a stipend, but there are also hidden, covert expenses. For example, if me as a fellow in training, if I'm doing X amount of surgeries, one should also understand those surgeries are using material. Those surgeries are, as I'm getting trained, are using, time of the faculty with respect to training. They are using resources. So all of this also has a cost, which actually the training place is spending on you, right? So it is not really that is the only amount of money that you have gained monetarily speaking. So these are sort of covert expenses that have been done on you from the training institute, towards your training.
Special invited, any question to the panelist?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yes. One by one. Harshini, please.
Yes, sir. Sir, I'm Dr. Harshini from Bangalore. Regarding fellowship, sir, why it is not universalized or it is MCI recognized? These are the few questions asked by my seniors and super seniors.
Dr. Grover, do you want to take the question?
Dr. Grover would be the...
I believe what you are asking is whether we have any way of standardizing the fellowships across the country, an evaluation process. I think the All India Ophthalmic Society did a yeoman job 3 years ago of creating a fellowship curriculum for all subspecialties, adapted it to Indian conditions, specified exactly what the institution needs to offer in terms of infrastructure and in terms of faculty, and specified exactly what a fellow needs to do during that period and how an evaluation process should go on. I think the All India Ophthalmic Society should now go on to implement that. That was a document which was prepared as a consensus document, taking in all the institutions of the country, including L.B. Prasad, Shankar Netralaya, Arvind, the All India Institute, PGI, Nanakai Center, everything. So that was a consensus document. We need to implement that so that we can have some kind of standardization in the duration, in the exact curriculum, and what we hope to achieve at the end, how to evaluate them. That is something which needs to be done, and we all need to be working to make sure that that comes true.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Dr. Siva.
So my question is, yes, sir. Sir, to Vivek, sir, I just wanted to ask, many times the thesis topic is different from the area of interest. So does that affect the fellowship interview?
No, not at all. Not at all. Again, whenever somebody is asking you with respect to your thesis, right? Understand what the panel or the person on the panel wants to know. The person on the panel, point one, wants to know how well you are articulating your title or your research topic. In short, how you are coming out with the flow of methodology. How you are coming to the conclusions and what is your take of how your conclusions are or are not changing practice in that subspecialty of ophthalmology where your thesis was slated to be, and whether you have taken that one step ahead and ended up attempting to publish your thesis. So basically it is trying to get into whether you have understood your research flow during your residency itself. Like I mentioned, most fellowship programs have research as a part of their module, and it's always nice to have a candidate who already has some sort of heads up with respect to research, because it becomes that much more easier for that person to understand a complete research sort of a setup that that person is entering into. So it has absolutely no bearing whether your topic of thesis and your subspecialty the interview is matching or it's different. It is how clear you are with respect to what you're saying.
I think as Vivek has pointed out, the objective of a thesis in the post-graduation, as you all know, is teaching you research methodology to get you into the flow of how to collect data, how to frame a question, how to answer it validly, and how to assess it and how to put it forth in terms of your results and discussion. So it is to inculcate the research methodology in you. And whether that has been incorporated in your thought process into your frame, that is what you are checking when you are asking a question on thesis.
Thank you, sir. So one more question, sir.
Okay.
Can I go ahead, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes. Ask. After that, Raghu will ask.
Okay, sir.
Harshini, ask,
sir,
please.
Yes, sir. I want to know about the training in Israel country. Can you please enlighten us regarding the training in Israel?
Training in where?
Israel. Training abroad in Israel.
No clue whether.
Okay, sir.
I don't know. I don't know whether Grover sir has. How do you get into Israel?
Sir, I can take this question.
I'm going to an oculoplastics meeting, which was supposed to be this May, but will be next March. After that, I'll come back and answer that question.
Sir, I can guide her a little bit.
training in Israel is not for the short-term fellowship. They usually involve you only in the long-term fellowship. I was in Israel last year and visited many institutes like Haifa and other. And whatever the trainer people are getting their training, they involved in the long-term projects, usually a 4 or 5 year, because they are working on it. Just like Rohit Shetty sir is doing, they are doing different kind of research. It is not only like fellowship or anything. They have some targeted some research project and they will involve you until it will finish. And usually it is of 3 to 5 years, not of any short-term training they are giving to the outsiders.
Any question?
Dr. Raghu?
One more question. What I would like to say is I am going into final year PG in a government medical college in Odisha. So what I am telling is that except Delhi, most of the state people who ended last year had signed a bond, and with the COVID condition and with the last year Supreme Court telling to do bond to make it strict, even our Odisha government is now just today made a thing to make a 2-year bond with 1 year SRship and 1 year peripheral bond in a anywhere in the periphery. So what I am asking is that they are giving a provision to go to higher study. So will fellowship will be considered as a higher study? And if they are allowing, should they go for fellowship, then again go back to such peripheral bond which can actually be detrimental, or should I complete the peripheral thing, then try for the fellowship?
Any panelist can answer, Ashwin? Can you understand the question? Sir, the problem of bond.
My knowledge, State bond.
Post you have to work after graduation in the villages.
As per my knowledge, Raghu, you have to contact to your MCI office, regular MCI office of the Odisha, or the read whatever the bond conditions are there, whether they allow or not, because none of us can guide or tell what is the government policy in the Odisha. If the government can allow you, you can go for any fellowship, and if they are not, you can ask. There will be the teacher or the DGME is there of your state who can reply. Just visit to their office in the Bhuvaneswar and they will tell you whether they will allow or not, because no one can help you. It's a government issue and government have idea, they have must have planned it. So when you can approach, they will tell you whether what is the term and condition of the Odisha state or the another state.
Yeah. May I add a point?
Yes.
So this is also something which on the other side possibly the institutes can explore. Say for example, when a similar thing came up for the Telangana and Andhra Pradesh states, so what was acceptable to them is the LVPI fellowship module, which for comprehensive ophthalmology had a 1 year peripheral rotation. And that they were accepting as a part which you have done as a rural service. So that sort of middle path where you are not really not pursuing fellowship, going and completing the bond and then attempting a fellowship, or attempting a fellowship and disregarding the bond completely. So a good middle path where that tenure was being accepted. So this is something where if a particular institute can also sort of, you know, negotiate if they have some sort of information or some sort of contacts with the particular authorities, then you may have some sort of a middle path where you can save some time for the candidate. But again, this will be, you know, case to case basis, and again, this will be state to state basis.
Any other question by panelists? Yes, Ashwarya,
unmute yourself. Sir, I want to know what exactly is fellowship in comprehensive ophthalmology, and what do we gain after that, and who should go for such a fellowship after residency?
I can let you know about our setup here, where the comprehensive fellowship is traditionally a three-year module. So here in we encourage those who strongly feel that their residency program has not been strong enough to make them confident about their basics, and their aim going ahead is to have a good grasp of general ophthalmology and possibly have a top-up skill. So it is for somebody who has that sort of a thought process clear. So if that is so, then the comprehensive ophthalmology module that we have been offering is broken into three parts, where in the first year you end up rotating through various departments, picking up the nuances and basics of those departments. In the second year, you are actually ending up being at one of the peripheral centers of LVPI for a tenure of a year. And there, it's like you are the whole and soul of that center. In some centers, there may be two fellows, but invariably there is one comprehensive fellow with the entire administrative armamentarium as at his or her disposal. So that's a really good phase where not only you do a lot of independent surgeries, you do a lot of independent decision making, but it's like you are running a small center. You are the top tier person to whom the entire staff reports to. So it's a good exercise for you where you can learn administration, fall back upon faculty at main campuses to ask your clinical or administrative questions and, you know, imbibe those answers again. So by the end of that 1 year, you are really confident as a general ophthalmologist who can also run a small center. And it is topped up in the third year by one particular subspecialty exposure, where the elements of exposure are completely charted out. Say, for example, if it's a comprehensive ophthalmologist who has a retina rotation or a retina top-up at the third year level, it is not going to be something which is equivalent to a pure retina fellow in terms of complexity of surgery. Here we are looking at somebody who can manage basic diabetic macular edema, somebody who can pick up a dropped nucleus, somebody who can do a basic end-off vitrectomy, somebody who can pick up dropped IOL. So some set of skills. I would not expect that comprehensive ophthalmology retina top-up to be doing complex macular holes, complex diabetic retinopathy, something like that. So again, this is how one module is. I'm sure each institute will have their own patterns. Herein is what I was alluding to in my talk, that when you're applying for a particular place, it should be important to know what pattern of training is going to be offered and whether that is in sync with what you aim for in higher training.
Tansu, sir, you conclude the session.
Yeah.
Sir, one last question.
Yes. Ashwa, go fast.
Sir, to Rashman, sir, I just wanted to know if we have to choose amongst FRTS and ICA exam, like if we have any time constraints or we can give only one exam, what would you prefer to give?
So these two are completely different exams with different philosophies and different way of preparation. But if you say that you are taking one more exam, more structured learning and then preparation for the exam, then ICU exams are structured very well for you to prepare. Only problem is that it does not have any contact with the examiner, so there is no practical exam. It's more like testing your theoretical knowledge. Versus you say that, you're going to upgrade clinical skill and make sure that you prepare yourself for the practice, then FRCS probably would be a better exam.
Okay. Ashwin, question from Merit, where we can get all the information about MCH, ECO, FRCS, is there any platform where they can get all the information?
So there are websites which lists out all the books which are required, the latest preparation. There are websites which actually have chat rooms where you can actually chat with the people who are writing the exam or discuss the cases. But I would suggest that if you want the concrete information, you should go to that particular Royal College. So Edinburgh College, Glasgow College, International College of Ophthalmology, because that would be the most authentic and up-to-date information.
So before we conclude, Dr. Grover, sir, as a chairperson, we'd like to have your comments over this webinar. And Ashwin.
Thank you, Satanshu, and thank you, Deepak. It has been a wonderful session. I'm sure all the residents and fellows have benefited a lot because it maps out their options after post-graduation. The post-graduation is a period when they are intensely focused on acquiring knowledge and skills, and they need to have objectives laid out as to what they are thinking of in the short term and in the long term by the time they end their post-graduation. And this discussion today should prepare them well to develop a process of thinking towards their future career options, looking at their basic situation of where they are placed, where they plan to settle down, and what their interests are. So I think this webinar has set them on a path of thinking. I'm sure they would benefit from it and take decisions in their best interest. Thank you very much for having brought together such people who had who have had experience with all the aspects that they spoke about and oriented all of us and all of the residents and fellows on those aspects. Thank you very much. It's been a very useful session.
Thank you. Rashwin, sir.
Rashwin.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, Deepak. Thank you, Dr. Mathur. It has been a wonderfully crafted program. And with Dr. Grover's presence, it became absolutely, it took to another level. All the faculty members, as Dr. Grover mentioned, did such a justice, and I really enjoyed this 2.5 hours. Though a lot of this hopefully would not affect me. I mean, I may not be appearing for a fellowship anytime soon, but I really enjoyed the talks. Thank you.
Vivek. Thank you. Vivek, I'm really impressed by your talk. May please unmute yourself. Yeah. I'm really impressed by your talk. This is very, very good for the all the PGs. What are your views about this webinar?
Thank you very much. I think it's a very unique webinar because everybody can study, everybody can get in clinical knowledge, but a lot of times people are not aware or they don't have the information as to how to go about training programs. And I think this fora like these are really important to give or disseminate that information as to what all avenues are available if you want to pursue higher education. How do you go about, how do you prepare? Because these are absolutely not certain things which are there in the book. These are all like, you know, practical aspects. So I think kudos to the entire management and organization for Dr. Mishra, for you. It was amazing. 2.5 hours just went by.
So please conclude the meeting, special invitees.
Yes.
Acharya.
Thank you, sir. I would like to conclude today's webinar by thanking our honorable chairpersons, moderators, and esteemed faculty for sparing their valuable time and sharing their experiences, mentoring us and opening various avenues to ophthalmology and its subspecialties. I would also like to thank Avesta Pharma for supporting this webinar. PG Examination Forum is a platform initiated by Dr. Deepak Mishra, sir. It is a forum where the members are provided with the latest study material and guidance. And it has now conducted 13 webinars till date, with 11 webinars crossing a viewership of more than 5,000. And to become a member of this family, send in your name and institution name to 94153-60338. I repeat, 94153-60338. Thank you.
Thank you, Aishwarya. Thank you, Dr. Drover, sir. Thank you, Rashmin, Vivek. And thank you, all special invitees.
Thank you, for supporting us this grant.
Avesta, yeah. Can we go offline, Avesta? Can we go offline?
Deepak Dameja is there. Deepak ji. Are you there?
Are we offline?
No, sir, I'm there. Very good there. Thanks for giving us an opportunity.
Aishwarya, please stop sharing. Yes. We are offline now.
Do you want to say something from
your side? No, just would like to thank SSTC for giving us an opportunity to be a part of this program. Really enjoyed. I think the postgraduate students would have definitely enjoyed every bit of it. And there was some learning for us also. that how things are changing shape as far as growth of ophthalmology is taking place, and how those teachers have been coming so much forward to help the students to do better in their future endeavors. Thank you very much once again for giving the opportunity, Deepak sir, Satanshu sir, and it was a lovely evening to hear so many stalwarts today. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Manjeet, we are offline.
Can we become offline now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, stop.
Yes, sir.